Hi, and welcome to After Hours with Bo and Tami right here on These Changing Times Radio.ning.com. How are you, Bo?
Pissed. I'm awful pissed.
Well, there's a lot going on, and of course, Rocko's still being maintained in McHenry County, Illinois, without being arraigned, of course. He's got his scheduled arraignment tomorrow morning. Last time, of course, he did not claim the name. He did not contract, and we're waiting on something. The court does not have jurisdiction over him, of course, to offset or discharge congressional bankruptcy, because he's not married to the Hughes. Never has been. She was always contracted with that state, the other father, and that is what is written.
Yeah, well, that's a big part of it. You know, he's been in there going on 2 weeks. It'll be 2 weeks Thursday, I believe.
Friday.
And let my people go. I mean, why when we follow the rules of the exchequer, we play the game accordingly. We win the game accordingly. And we still come up against a brick wall, mostly because of the media weight out there, okay? Because we have all these lemmings that are following Alex Jones, or let me ask you something. Has Alex Jones sued Congress? Has he ever pointed the finger exclusively at Congress? Okay? All right, and all these other guys, okay? We are changed. I want my constitutional rights. Now, they had a good story today. Though, I mean, I like them for their news, you know, but this activist on there was a activist that promotes constitutionalism and, you know, First Amendment rights, blah, blah, blah. And if you listen to any of our stuff at all, you know what utter nonsense that is. Okay? It's just more bullshit for you to fill yourselves up with, okay, and keep you from seeing the truth of the matter, which is that they took your rights from you in the first place in order to be able to sell them back to you.
Right,
wake the fuck up!
Right. And this is relative to Matthew 27. When the media presented to the sheeple and asked them whether or not, well, do you like this system? Do you want to patronize this system? And ultimately, it came down to, quote, let him be crucified. Yes, we like our benefits. We like our rights. We like our pretend foods wrapped up in shiny packaging and everything else. And this is the point we're at now. This is the absolute. Are this citizens, sheeple, citizens, individuals, free man on the land, patriots, are they going to realize what this is and stand up on behalf of their fellow human being? Or are they going to allow Jesus to continuously be crucified and maintained in such manners?
Or are they just all false prophets because we've reached out to many of these individuals, okay, and explained to them how the game works, but they want to go on playing their game? Such as a rod class, we got some more breaking information for you on how bad they're screwing us. Well, I'm going to go back in there and plead some more.
And these, you know, poor idiot sheriffs, constitutional sheriffs, I saw some news come through today. They're standing, quote, against the FBI, and they're really not if they're adhering to the Bill of Rights and all of these bullshit laws that were implicated or put into place or put in action to enable human trafficking. And, you know, as things are playing out, we're finding more and more that perhaps these law enforcement are also guilty. We have allowed them the opportunity to learn now. We've personally contacted them on a continual basis for the last year, reaching out to them on all of our shows and all of our teachings, and again, personal contact throughout this time that Rocko's been in there. And you know, maybe they don't know what to do. Maybe they're so used to taking up these orders from these attorneys in black dresses. Maybe they're scared or they're fearful, but Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. For those that save their own life, you shall lose it. And that's, again, it's crunch time.
And that's the time we're at now. And this is the situation to the minute. All the paperwork that needs to be entered has been entered. Everything is there. The monies are waiting for the sheriff that executes the first order under the public law, okay, which hasn't happened yet. And they're going to find out quickly, if they don't know already, that their departments are running dry. I don't know what they're running off of. Fumes, donations, contributions, charities. I don't know, those that are aiding and abetting the known enemy, as they were found guilty to the matter of genocide. Okay? All right, Congress is killing you all worldwide. GMO foods. We got Obama, you know, he's going to go ahead and give the okay to start killing U.S. citizens on U.S. soil. We got, you know, CIA stirring up shit everywhere in Syria and Libya, and, you know, Syria and Iran are on targets again. They want to see what you people will continue to consent to.
Especially because they're telling you what they're doing. In the Belfast Telegraph this week, the CIA said, well, what we do is if there's a need for somebody to have child porn on their computer, we'll put it there for them. If there's a need for somebody to have naked pictures on their cell phones, we'll put it there for them. That's what the CIA does. It produces intelligence. It produces information. And then they go ahead and locate the law enforcement from there. And then law enforcement investigates these things, finds the child porn, finds the naked pictures, finds the whatever the CIA wanted to put there to maintain the production, and that's where the investigation stems from. So it's always created out of artificial intelligence, of course, promoted through the CIA. And now that the CIA is actually admitting to this, if the sheeple do not stand up at this point in time, then those lemmings can go ahead and go into the system as well, because we've done everything in our power and our authority. But it's up to the sheeple citizens whether or not they're going to continue to patronize this thing and call it their father or not. Like I said, it's crunch time. Jesus is on the cross. If the sheeple don't stand up, that's up to them.
You know, as I've stated before, I'm not the most eloquently spoken radio talk show host. Okay, nor did I ever have any ambitions of being a radio talk show host. Okay, I find myself here out of the laws of necessity at this point. All right, and there's nobody else willing, apparently, or capable of doing it. But as I've tried to lay out for you, Tammy's tried to lay out for you, Rocko has tried to lay out for you. All right, we have others out there that are walking the walk, and, you know, those numbers are few and far between, but they get it. There are a few out there that get it, all right? Now since studying with Tami, you know, I've come to understand the truth of the matter, the rules of the Exchequer, how far this goes back. Okay, this isn't about the United States of America and that piece of paper, Constitution, Declaration of Independence. Yeah, well, it's about that, but not in the way you think. Okay, these are things, these are mechanisms that they used to hook you in, to be their sureties, so they can offset their congressional bankruptcy and stuff their pockets at your demise.
Articles of incorporation maintained by a business. It's a corporation. Each one, Article 1, Article 2, Article 3, Article 4, Amendment to Article whatever. These are articles of incorporation of a criminal enterprise, a business model. And to patronize it is the same thing as allowing Walmart to human traffic.
Yeah, because it's all the corporations, too. Through these articles of incorporation, these corporations that are listed with the Council on Foreign Relations are the government.
Absolutely.
They are the government. Absolutely. Google, government. Absolutely. All right? Now, wrap your minds around that. And think about that flag that so many of you are still saluting, being patriotic to, paying your taxes, voting, okay? All this shit is just leading us further down the road.
Well, and the people need to consider, you know, when you're laid off from your job in one of these corporations, and then you seek forever to find another job with another corporation of the corporate governance, and you take a pay cut, and you take a hit to your retirement, and you take a hit to your 401k programs, and you take all of these hits, that's the same corporation doing this. It doesn't matter what its face is, Sears, Walmart, Google, Amazon. Any one of these things are your corporate governance. So you were laid off for a reason. You were fired for a reason. You lost your job for a reason. And that was to put you down on your knees, to teach you to be a better PC product. And when you're taught to be a good boy or a bad boy and a bad girl, you're taught that you are these things. Ultimately, you patronize that thing to a greater extent because you feel lost. You feel alone. You feel like you've done something wrong. It's just a business model, and as Phil told me one time, it's just business. That's all it is. It's just business. Your children are human trafficked to make money for these corporations. You are trafficked to make money for these corporations. You're murdered every day. 42 women a day, 42 females a day are dying from what they say is prescription drug overdose. Those are the intentions of these medications, and we've been reporting on that the last couple months here since we were able to evidence the facilitation of genocide against the human populace through the medical industry. You know, Ativan, lorazepam, hydrocodone, all of these medications are now being used to execute human beings through lethal injection. But you are diagnosing yourself by the television programming. You're running to the doctor for these things. So you want to be sleepy. You want to be, maintained in this comfortable zone where you don't have to deal with anything and everything else can go on around you. Even though you're being slaughtered slowly through low-intensity conflict, fourth-generation warfare, you're not...
Or quickly, if you have suicide by cop.
Absolutely. Yeah, these things are all...
Which almost happened to Rocko.
Yep.
If we hadn't been on the phone with them, they would have murdered him.
Right. They were in the action of doing this. I'm still waiting on some type of order that ordered this. They had tased him at least 12 times from the recording that I could hear. And at one point in time, it sounded like he was stuck with something. A female voice came on and said, "This is going to pinch." He said, "What are you doing? What are you doing to me?" And then within 10 minutes, he started getting kind of loopy. His voice started getting slurred and whatever else. And ultimately, they said they were going to lay him on his back. And at one point in time, he's saying that he's having chest pains and everything else. And at that point in time, you know, it was just after that, after they had tased him so many times, that I coughed so that they could hear me in his pocket. And at that point in time, they found the phone, of course, and told him it was dead and closed it. And that was very interesting to me to witness that in all of its actuality because, again, I don't know if it was the marshals intentionally trying to kill him because, of course, there's always an order that has to be that they're executing. And so I want to know who was directing them to do these things against Robert Richard. There will be accountability. I mean, it's not like I'm going away anytime soon or Bo's going away anytime soon.
And it's not like this process is going to be stopped now anyways. The writing's on the wall. If you guys cannot see what's going on in the mainstream news, we've got more, shenanigans with other politicians, you know, that's being broadcast exposed on the mainstream media. We got teachers going into the shoot. One today I covered, a female was claiming that her nude photo's been stolen, you know, when in reality somebody got her cell phone, posted them on a revenge site. Okay, now she's done with being a fifth grade science teacher. Okay, I mean, you know how they would have covered this up in the past. Okay, same thing with you cops out there. They're now starting to feel the brunt. Okay, all right. I put this stuff out on my YouTube channel every single day. Tami covers it on her show. We cover it on the Bo and Rocko show. You know, it's coming down, and I can't even keep up with all the stories anymore. I mean, you know, look at this. I've got a stack of papers right here that is nothing but, you know, cops, attorneys, you know, judges, all getting arrested. All right? Now, that's because their funding has been shut off. I don't know how else I got to prove this. I put the IMF screenshots up on the Dropbox the other day. Okay, you can see them when their funding was cut. The House of Lords isn't, supplying any treasury monies to these criminals. This is the first song we played was Big Money, all right? And that's what this is about. This is about big money now, because throughout the course of history, these psychopaths have devised this mechanism to siphon off your wealth, going back at least 1,000 years. Okay, I'm going to say 1180, separation of the spiritual and temporal, you know, at least. But it was going on before that, too. This scheme of bankruptcy is something these psychopaths came up with a long time ago, and they've hid it and cloaked it very connivingly and gotten you to consent with it through the generations. You're brought up in these schools, you know, by your indoctrinated parents, you know, think it's okay to send you to a state-sponsored school, which is going to turn around and turn you into a better product, so you can perpetuate this system of throwing you under the bus for offsetting their congressional bankruptcy and lining their pockets. Okay, now, we called them on this, all right? Now, I don't know why we don't have any other quote-unquote gurus out there jumping on board with this, because I personally think the reason is that because every goddamn one of them are a bunch of CIA agents.
And it could be. I mean, we're looking at this thing that was created as a marquee. Just this house, a tent where a circus is performed. You got court jesters all over the place, and that's all this is. And going back to the public school system itself, or Hitler youth camps. Now, every one of our listeners right now and throughout time, you know, they've had dealings with their out-of-control teenagers, their out-of-control children, and they're blaming their children for not listening to them. But they're the ones that are putting their children in these public school systems where they're being taught that their parents don't have any authority and that their parents are retarded. They're being taught that their parents can't tell them what to do, can't do this, can't do this. And so the authority, the absolute institution of family, of community, has been destroyed through the action of low-intensity conflict, which is a war tactic. These are war tactics. As somebody tells your child, that you are not the authority, that's automatically busting apart the institutionalization or the institution of family. That's its purpose, to separate you, to divide and conquer, to enable it to do what it's doing.
Yeah, that's right. And preying on your kids. You send them to school to be preyed on.
Absolutely.
Okay, by feminism, you know, Alinsky method. You know, your boys are being feminized. Okay, your females are being empowered by feminism. So, which to perpetuate this whole system. All right, which is exactly the setup going back to 1180 with the separation of the spiritual and temporal. You know, Tami was posting earlier, I saw in one of the rooms how what was that you were saying now? I lost my train of thought here. You know, the males have been demonized, you know. This system of demonizing the males and taking the males off of the protection, so the females run to the other daddy, which is the state.
And the predator.
Now anybody that hasn't seen the King's bankruptcy out there, this is a YouTube video. And it's on my channel, Bono's Entertainment. You need to listen to that, because that video pretty much outlines just about everything on how this situation is going on, up until and including the point where Congress, calling itself the King, declares bankruptcy in 1933, and through covert means, well, actually, what, 29 was the bankruptcy, okay, and that's when the Geneva Convention also occurred.
33 was bankruptcy, but they had postured setting up for this last bankruptcy using the 1929 Geneva Convention.
They're all postures. All the old charters. Absolutely. Okay, the Magna Carta, the Sestakivai Act, the Declaration of Independence, Articles of Confederation, Constitution of the United States of America, and it goes on and on. It's all posturing, and it's all building a more complex matrix. You know, dumbing down the people with the foods and the educational system to the point where many of you can't even comprehend what it is we're even talking about.
And you'll shut off. That's what's known as cognitive dissonance. And when you go study the aspect of Stockholm Syndrome, you're patronizing a captor in exchange for protection. Everybody stopped suffering from Stockholm Syndrome. They think, well, this is scary. I'm going to be arrested. Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. If you save your life, you'll lose it. Period. No narcissism. No, absolutely no narcissism. Take up your cross and follow Jesus. There's no question there. He didn't tell you, well, if you feel like it, or you know, if you arm yourself first, which is so stupid. Why would you be doing that? That's what the Pope does. The Pope has armed guards around him. He's got a bulletproof car.
Yeah, trust in God. Hey, I got a full staff of security today, don't I?
Absolutely. He has no faith. He has no hope, and he has no charity whatsoever, and his priests don't either.
But I don't even care about him, you know, at the moment. Okay, he's a figurehead, all right? He's running diversion for Congress.
Absolutely.
We've got all these lemmings out there saying, oh, the Vatican is behind it all. And the Freemasons, and yeah, they're a part of it. Okay, you know what they are? They're tentacles of Congress through the 1947 National Security Act in some manner or fashion. But going back to this bankruptcy in 1933, all right? 1933, that's how long ago? We're talking 81 years ago. And Congress appoints itself through covert means the trustee of the bankruptcy.
And then says, you're the one that's bankrupt.
Yeah. Yeah, they told you you're the one that's bankrupt, but they're the ones that are bankrupt. Then they appoint themselves through covert means, like they said. It looks like the Federal Reserve is the trustee of the bankruptcy. The Federal Reserve is another tentacle of Congress.
Right. It's a mechanism, and it only moves according to market condition. It's reservation on rights.
And so who they appoint the strong-arm thugs to be overseers of the bankruptcy is the U.S. Marshals. Okay? That's right in your face. U.S. Marshals overseeing the bankruptcy of the United States
Inc.
Incorporated. Okay, you lost your government in 1933, folks. It was a corporation, and the only reason it continues is because you keep consenting.
Patronizing it, calling it your father.
Your god.
Yeah, demigod. You're calling a demigod your father because it gives you things. It gives you welfare and social security benefits and veterans benefits. But on the flip side, how many of you are, is it killing? As it gives you that benefit, they're cashing in. You're only going to get 0.82% in the debenture participation program. Now, debenture participation. You know the word partake means to participate, to eat up, to buy into. So what you're doing is you're partaking of the tree of knowledge. In the garden, right now, not past tense. And once you partake of that tree of knowledge in the garden, you've given up the garden. That's how Congress owns your garden. You're patronizing it and calling it your father, and it's giving you rights or benefits, which is the doctrine of election. You are never going to get both, and you are never the heir. Congress called itself the heir back at the original charters and said, well, we're seceding these estates. Secession means to take over an estate on behalf of a dead person, on behalf of the deceased. Now, are you dead? Yes. If you're claiming to be a fiction, you're not alive. You're not living. You're not there. You're a fiction. You're a negotiable instrument.
That's right. Now we get the idea of the fictitious plaintiff set up in these court systems. All right. Man, we've explained this stuff all before. You know, this is where we're at now, though, in that the real sheriff has got to come forward. And the only way that's going to happen is with enough pressure and media. I can only do so much. Tami can only do so much. But if you don't rise up right now, you're all going to be squashed like ants. Now, we're probably facing global extinction if we don't stop what's going on real soon here with the disaster at Fukushima, all right, which is basically due to corporate greed, which was facilitated through corporations having rights reserved over yours through that 14th Amendment, okay? Now, the idea of the 14th Amendment is nothing new, okay? But when they passed it back in the 1860s, that kind of solidified things for the corporations, and we've been on a slowly downhill slope of having human beings being thrown under the bus for the betterment of the corporations, which are your federal government through the Articles of Association, Articles of Incorporations. All right? Now, the states came into this corporate structure through the Acts of Enablement, which started in 1802, but it's no different. Not one slight difference other than what they may be called on paper. Their Acts of Enablement, Articles of Incorporation, Articles of Association, it's all one big thing. This is all one big leviathan that the ignorance of the sheeple has helped perpetuate, unfortunately, for all of us. Now, we found them guilty of genocide through their own documentation, through their own congressional action. Congress, as you may recall, means with transgression, and you keep patronizing the thing that's transgressing on you. Go ahead, Tami.
I know. It's very frustrating, and then we've got the pre-scribes and Pharisee coming back in again, and especially the last 2 weeks, calling us meanies for calling out the citizens and the citizens and sheeple. And they're saying, well, I'm the nice guy. I'm the church here that can offer you food bank services when you're starving. I'm the nice guy because I can feed you so much crap, and you'll buy into this. You'll buy into the tree of knowledge, and you'll buy these concepts from me, the Lord God. And it's so sad to see that some are still buying into this game because of their patronage, patriotism, because of their experiences that they've experienced. And bottom line, because of selfishness and narcissism. Because they're protecting the self over the other self, the one that you look at every day. That human being that's being destroyed by Congress, that child that's being raped by congressional action, that child that's being raped by the local judge, pastor, priest, psychiatrist, and all of these things that everybody has suffered. Every human being on this planet has suffered. It used to be, you know, I know this girl that got raped, or I know this boy that got raped, and now it's down to the point where I got raped, my child got raped, my niece got raped, and it's not hit or miss anymore. It's blatant in your face that this is what this business does. And it's not ever, ever, ever I got raped by a stranger. It's I got raped by a cop, I got raped by a teacher, I got raped by a pastor, I got raped by a priest, I got raped by a judge, I got raped by an attorney. And all of these things need to go away, because those things cannot happen. They cannot happen if you're not patronizing that thing, and if you're removing them from the ability to harm, which is what Jesus taught. He did not teach forgiveness. He taught compassionate justice. Remove them. If the eye offends you, pluck it out. Take it off. Get it away from you. And forgive financial crimes, which are not harm against humanity. And it's just so perverted that money and things can be more important than human beings, babies, men, women, and children.
And here you are, still being patriotic to that thing, okay, after we told you what they're doing, okay, and they've even told you in their own writings that you are the enemy, okay? The Amended Territory Act, which updated the Trading with the Enemies Act, which was the kickoff to World War I, that act made you, the American citizen, enemies of the state. Every single one of them. Every single one of you.
And the 1947 National Security Act solidified that. And said that the nations, each foreign state, each county, each corporation has life over you, which stems from the 14th Amendment, the legal concept of person. That thing has life above and beyond yours. And so it's being protected since the 1947 National Security Act. Those are foreign nations. Each corporation is defined as a foreign nation under 28 U.S.C. Chapter 97. You can find the definitions in 28 U.S.C. Subsection 1603. And in this, you are being maintained to facilitate corporate welfare. So every time that what's his name with the bad hair goes bankrupt, You're subscribing to that. That's a millstone wrapped around your neck, and you're discharging that bankruptcy by your productivity, by your product, by being that product, by being maintained as a product, a fictional character in a play, in a marquee, the House of Representatives. I pray every day that you hear us. That's all it takes.
I hate to tell you this, and I don't want to seem like a braggart, but this is the only game in town. We've got the only bond out there that has any weight in reality whatsoever. What you guys are buying into with the federal state is a fiction. All right? And a lot of you are going to find out the hard way. A lot of you. Cops are finding out the hard way right now. Okay? What we was able to do in this court case is swap the surety, which had been the human beings since 1929 Geneva Convention. We swapped that with the fiction. What is the fiction? Well, those that have a fictitious government. Okay? Those attorneys that have a fictional government called the bar, which includes so-called judges, which we evidence in our case were not judges at all. They were attorneys wearing black dresses with stampers that say judge on them, that their clerks stamp on your court papers. Okay?
Psychopaths that are forever seeking the self, that can never maintain their own government. If a psychopath cannot have its own government, it's not able. It can say, I'm the king, but its works and actions do not evidence that it is anything other than a psychopath and one that is seeking the self by control. And that's where we're at now. The human being, you know who you are. You know your authority, or you will. You are the most authority. You are the most important being in this game, and you must realize that immediately. And again, I pray that you all hear me, because this is you we're talking about. This isn't me. I'm already off the grid. Bo's already off the grid. I am not owned. I'm not being tricked out. Now, with Rocko in there, this is political pressure. This is called politics. This is the game of politics. And they want Rocko to consent. They want us to purchase him. They've got a $1,000 bond without an arraignment on him at this time. They want us to purchase from them. They want us to purchase their law. I don't purchase their law. Now, I've lost everything in the last 14 years. And for all of those law enforcement and maybe the judges that might be listening right now, this last year, a year and a half ago or so, the FBI took my daughter. And upon that time, when the FBI took my daughter, you know, of course she's consenting now. At that time, she was 17, and the FBI was, of course, employing pedophiles. Now, this year, they were threatening me with harm upon my daughter. And I turned around and I said, you're going to do what you're going to do. Now, my rules are 1 Corinthians 13. I am to suffer, bear all things, experience all things, believe all things, hope all things. And my rules are faith, hope, and charity, which means trust. Whatever you may do, you will do. That's your will. But I can guarantee you, by the evidence, you will be held accountable for your works and actions. I'm not going to cry. I'm not going to go run and try to save anybody. I'm not going to purchase them from your system. Those are not my rules. You will do whatever you will do, but you will be held accountable. And that's the evidence of your works and actions, is upon your doing these things. Now, you have a choice. I was given a choice in free will to either offer you resistance or allow you to do what you're going to do, by which to evidence your works and actions. And in my free will, you will be evidenced according to your works. That is how you're held accountable. There's no due process there. Evidence speaks for itself. There is nothing there. Once you've done these things, you're evidenced to have done these things. And we have given the opportunity to all law enforcement, to all judges, to all attorneys, to take their hands back out of the pot, to limit liability. And this is what it comes down to. Culpability, accountability, liability. So if you are involved in these things, even if you're not a direct actor, you will be held accountable. You know, guilty by association, for example. If you work for a criminal enterprise and my daughter happens to be killed, you will be held accountable for her death. These things are evidenced by your works. And even if your peer happens to do something to one of my family members or whoever, you will be held accountable for that because your peer is a psychopath. They usually have more money than you do because you're an agent of somebody else, which means that you're the fall guy. So right now is your choice in all things, just exactly as I had a choice in all things. That's the bottom line. The Commerce Clause of the Constitution says you can do whatever you want to under acts of commerce and private acts. But the restrictive principle of sovereign immunity and the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act says if you're caught, you're screwed. Doesn't matter who you are. And I don't care. I don't care if you're not acting as to God's word. I could care less. Whatever happens to you will happen to you. We've been trying to reach out to you and limit your liability, limit the, it's actually, political cannibalism is so much like drawing and quartering. And this is why we speak to you directly day after day, hour after hour. Because I don't like to witness those things, but I know they're going to occur. But in the end, if you are guilty of harm upon a human being, you're going to be held accountable regardless. And I know that for the average citizen and the average human being, you know, that's not normal to our thought processes to have hatred or have anger in us to this extent. However, that is compassionate justice. And because I'm a human being, be living state, a sovereign state of being, my children are most important. The children are most important. And if there's a threat upon humanity that is not removed, that could influence or harm my children, then what are we doing here as a life on this planet, as a biology? What are we doing here if we can lay down, which is law, and take all of these things without removing that harm from its ability to harm any further? What are we here for? Any other biology would have already killed the predator. They would have adapted to the point where if they're a small vermin, they would have killed the wolf. They would have adapted to any and all forces and maintained death to the predator. And yet humanity, because of conceptual influence, psychological influence, and construct, they've been allowing this predation to continuously occur throughout history. And enough is enough. I do not care what happens to you if you've harmed a human being. And as I said, it's very painful. Political cannibalism is when you start praying for death of your body, because it's the action of drawing and courting, and that's what Jesus said. In one hour, you will lose everything.
Yeah, as this guy found out here, now I started out talking about this story that we are change covered today, and again, I'm not going to say that I'm a supporter, because they're still patronizing the system. However, the news that they came out with, inmate writes letter about guards causing the death of a fellow inmate, gets thrown in solitary confinement while other witnesses are transferred to other jails. See, this guy had a $96 fine and received a death sentence in jail from these prison guards. Okay, that's what concerns me about what's going on with Rocko right now. All right, because the debtor's prison system that it really is, okay, is a farce on its face to begin with. All right? Now that they have Rocko as a political prisoner, essentially, they have him behind bars. They're the thugs with the guns acting on a void order from this judge. You know, but this is the danger he is in. All right? And the media weight right now doesn't seem behind us. We've got, you know, almost 5,000 views on this video from We Are Change. I've got like maybe 500 on the latest I have featured on, you know, Rocko's situation. And, you know, people just don't care unless it's sensationalized or it's got a pretty girl in a bikini on the cover. You know, the populace is so dumbed down and programmed, all right, that, no, what we're saying is not popular or glamorous or exciting, all right? Well, there's some excitement, but, you know, people do not like hearing the truth. They want the easier-to-believe truth, the one that they can actually chew on and digest, all right? They don't want the kind of truth that we're telling you here about what's going on and how this is the king's bankruptcy that's affecting all of us and we're under the rules of the exchequer. They want to think, oh, I live in the greatest country in the world, you know, which is a fiction created by the attorneys, by the way. You know, I lost two legs in Vietnam, but I'd happily go back and you know, and get my third leg and my two arms, you know, if necessary for the you know, for the country. Oh, what? They cut off my VA benefits? Oh.
I hate them now. We got to do something about this because I lost money. But they've already killed the wife, the kids, the family members.
They've broken up the family. All right? They killed my mom. They're killing your mom. They killed Phil's dad. Through the medical industrial complex that is the federal state, okay, that has death derivatives on you. When your insurance runs out, rest assured, you will die in these medical facilities. I don't care how good of health you are when you go in there. As we found out, and it's seen over and over again, when you go in there, your health quickly deteriorates. And now it's come out that these cocktails that they're using to now kill people on death row are the same ones that they're feeding our loved ones that are allegedly being cared for.
Right. And what you're not seeing is that these medications, lorazepam, hydrocodone, these depress the lungs. And throughout time, your body enters into congestive heart failure. Now, a while back, I did a call for Jessica Bingham, and she was being arrested at that time. We ended up calling the law enforcement in Texas. They did not have their arrest listed, meaning they were probably going to take her out. They had already had her children in their custody and care by the time I called. And this is on a YouTube channel called Miss Just Another Human, which is Jessica's mother. Yesterday, I was on my Facebook wall, and Elizabeth is in a coma at this time in Washington State. And I haven't had any more updates since that time. But throughout a long span of time, she was on these medications. She was on these things. She was reliant on the medical industry. And at the last moment, she tried to step out. And it quickly turned downhill. And you can go through Miss Just Another Human's YouTube channel and watch her videos. And start around October when she didn't have congestive heart failure. And then, you know, follow it through as she's been diagnosed with diagnosis after diagnosis. And at this time, the last I heard was that she is in a coma. And our thoughts and prayers go out to her. But we've all experienced these things because of that patriotism to the hospital, to the county, to the state, to the benefit, to the Medicare system. And we have to walk away from that because it always ends in death when you do that. Now they're playing a game out in D.C. This is on the Washington Post today. Top D.C. judge allegedly steered contract to partner's husband and lied to investigators. The district chief administrative judge allegedly steered a $43,000 city contract to the husband of a business partner, hired that business partner into a city job, and lied to investigators probing the actions the city ethics board charged Thursday. No. See, this is normal day-to-day business for these judges. They're contracting with the local developers through the municipal bonds. That's what those bonds are. And what do you think it binds? These things are fixing bets, first of all. Municipal hedge funds are betting against and insuring the original bet. But what are these bonds? They bind human beings. And so this is what a judge normally does. This is day-to-day banking for the bank. However, he's being nailed for doing his job. He's being politically cannibalized. And anybody that's out there listening right now, this is a top DC judge, the district chief administrative law judge. This is the chief financial officer for the bank there in that incorporated state, DC. And for all you cops and agents and attorneys and little fall guys, what do you think's coming down the pike at you for doing your job? They've taken more CIA agents out. I know that in October, September, we were covering a story of the director of the CIA operations was taken out for grooming a defense company in Japan. Now this last week, they're nailing several others. They're charging them with bribery and prostitution. That was their job. That was what they were told to do by their handlers. They were doing it. And now they're what? Sitting in prison, facing charges, fines, fees. They are the new surety. But to all of you fall guys out there, if you're not aware of these things and you're not seeing what's going down, you're going to be sidelined really quickly here.
Yeah, I mean, how many times have we seen the people getting, you know, cannibalized for doing their job, all right? You know, people want to argue with me all day long, priests and scribes out there on the internet, and, you know, personally, I'm beginning to think you're all a bunch of goddamn agents, because nobody could be this stupid. Look at what's going on. All right, I'm sorry this is causing a shitstorm. This is the only way for this to end. And the longer it takes for the real sheriff to come forward and do his job as a steward for humanity, the longer this plays out and the more would-be potential stewards are going to go down. Sheriffs are not immune. FBI agents are not immune. Congressmen are not immune. The whole dynamics of the situation has changed.
Absolutely. And one of the funniest things that happened this week, for me, I'm laughing anyway, is the officer that was charged in down south, let me see where it is here. I'll get this up. Many officers. There was three this morning that I pulled up. So already, you know, yesterday it was like six altogether. And but this one officer, and let me, you know, create the venue here. Okay, everybody's being taught privacy laws, identity theft, and all of these things. Well, this officer and any other undercover officer listening at this time out there, you need to be aware of these things. So an officer of the law enforcement officer normally walks around and they do undercover work and everything. Well, this one was doing undercover work, and they used different identifications, and they used different credit cards. This one was nailed for identity theft for doing his job. And this is profound because you're not listening. Oh, I'm immune from that. I'm special because I have a different title. I'm officer so-and-so, and I have number whatever on my badge, and I'm protected by that badge. No, you're not. No, you're not. They took out CIA operations director, which is right under the CIA, right under the National Security Council. I mean, top level here, folks. They took him out for bribery when he was grooming a defense corporation in Japan, which was his function. That's what an operations director does for the CIA. And now here, you're disappearing too. You're being murdered every day, and you're not realizing of what all is going on. This week, the story was, let me get it up here for that director. Third senior Navy official arrested in bribery prostitution scandal. And this is on NBCnews.com, National Broadcasting Corporation. Quote, a third senior U.S. Navy official was arrested Wednesday and charged with accepting prostitutes, luxury travel, and cash from a foreign defense contractor in exchange for classified and internal Navy information, the U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of California announced. U.S. Navy Commander Jose Luis Sanchez, 41, was arrested in Tampa, Florida, Wednesday. He is accused of accepting prostitutes, $100,000 in cash, and other bribes from Leonard Francis, a Malaysian contractor known in military circles simply as, quote, Fat Leonard, end quote. In turn, prosecutors said Sanchez gave sensitive U.S. Navy information to Francis, Singapore-based company, Glen Defense Marine Asia, or GDMA, which helped it overcharge the Pentagon for servicing Navy ships in the Pacific. So, the Pentagon is contracting with Glen Defense Marine Asia, or GDMA, and it's rolling on its CIA operations. Hello?
Hello?
Is there anybody out there? I should put that on as a break, too. We should take a small break real quick while I grab something to drink. I'll put a song on there. But these things are like crazy as can be when everybody is just, they're so dumbed down by the system. These cops that we're dealing with, they're so dumbed down. They're required to have low IQs. They're taught that they're bad boys and bad girls. They go into law enforcement because they're missing their father. They're patronizing something and calling it father in exchange for this protection. What protection? What protection? Ask yourself that. And we'll be right back, folks. We're going to enter into a small break. And we're back, and you're listening to Bo and Tami After Hours on These Changing Times, radio.ning.com. We are a listener-supported radio station. And if you'd like to donate, please go to the homepage, and over on the right, you can find the donate button. Patty allows us to have this venue, and we're so thankful to Patty and everybody, Zeets, everybody at thesechangingtimes.ning.com. For their efforts, their work, and what they put into these things, you know, and we've got to get the word out. We've got to get everybody standing at once, together, united, the United States of being, which was usurped by actions of a criminal enterprise. And this is the point we're at now. Bo wanted to get into everything. It's yours, Bo.
Well, yeah, okay, those songs we just heard, of course, Pink Floyd, The Timeless, and the question is there anybody out there? And Tami says, well, I like to let people decompress a little bit, you know. No, I said, put some snap your fingers on, because I want you to feel the shock and awe, and I want you to get angry, okay? Because They're killing you, folks. All right? And most of you out there are still patronizing the goddamn thing. Now, thankfully, we're on after hours here on TCT where, you know, language can slip away from us from time to time. And it's not my usual operating mode. I've had it. I mean, I started out down this thing, you know, just to try to get my kids back from an unlawful kidnapping of my kids. All right? Little did I know that in the court system, I find myself slapped down by special drawing rights coming out of the International Monetary Fund that is supporting that lawless woman to do whatever the fuck she wants to you. All right? Now, I've been fighting this basically, you know what, 3.5 years, I've had my kids held by this woman who had no lawful authority to take them out of state in the first place. All right? And then what kind of bullshit is this that I have to come into this system, go through the ecclesiastical route and walk the gauntlet, run the gauntlet of getting preyed on by these cops, attorneys, and so-called judges just so I could evidence this shit, all right? We could turn it over to the House of Lords, who's the keepers of the ecclesiastical law.
The Treasury.
We had to show how the United States Incorporated had voluntarily withdrawn from the IMF to take their money away from them.
And that was...
Set up our own court, all right? Find them guilty of genocide. Find them guilty of human trafficking. Okay? This is all the shit I've gone through just to try to get my kids back from a situation that was unlawful on its face to begin with.
And for all those that will cast doubt upon hearing this, that he doesn't have his kids back yet, Vanessa, his ex-wife, psychopath, was working for the Attorney General, Denver County Attorney General in Colorado. And when we brought the evidence to the surface that she was human trafficking and holding children hostage in exchange for money, they let her go. First, they put her on administrative leave, and then ultimately she was fired. Well, what they did, and unbeknownst to them, is, of course, by their works and actions, they're already guilty. They've already admitted by their works, by firing her and letting her go, that, yes, she was guilty of those things. And what they were doing is cleaning their hands. Well, now, recently, she started working for Western Dairy Association, which is an arm of the Denver County Corporation. So they just switched her and transferred her over to another position, another visual presentation, but it's still the same corporation, and they will be held accountable for this. So even though they're shifting and they're playing clean hands doctor and everything else, they're still guilty. They hired a known kidnapper. She's taking hostages, and it's not just her, and that's part of, you know, the case with Rocko as well, is that during your relationship, no matter if you had a marriage license in your hand or not, that was only a rental agreement, a rental contract with her original daddy. And she's since, before, she was contracted with the state in the action of marriage. And that's what they're not getting at this time. They don't think that they're going to be held accountable. But the husband is responsible for her debts. You're not her husband. She was never, ever, 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 ever married to you. She was always contracted with the state, regardless of that piece of paper. And that is the actuality, the physical state of marriage. The contract of marriage is her contracting with the state and looking at the state as her husband. It's protecting her. It's providing her comfort. It's giving her jobs. And she's garnering these benefits and rights and everything else. Title and all of these things from her husband. And the husband is going to be held accountable, will be held accountable for her works. He's responsible for her.
Yeah, well, not anymore because of the quit claim. Okay, attention, attention, all government agencies. I have quit claimed that thing known as Vanessa Denise Robinson Alsop. Right? She's no longer my responsibility. Federal, state, her husband, she's yours.
Right, and that's by her works and actions. She married the state when she brought forth the false allegations. Those were never argued. She agreed that they were false allegations. The state agreed that they were false allegations. The attorney general's office agreed that they were false allegations, and that's why it let her go. These things were all founded on and based on fraud. And part of that was that she was in the action of being married to the state the entire time. You know, you're not the responsible party. You never were. But the premise was, under the rules of bankruptcy, is that the husband is responsible for her. So they had the millstone wrapped around your neck until you provided evidence that she wasn't yours. She wasn't yours to begin with.
Yeah, and back in the day, I tried to do this, you know. I immediately started studying all this statute and code and all this, you know, this mechanism that they've created. You know, I put in exhibits back then. I was using exhibits before I found the power of the admission statements. Okay. All right. Still coming in pleading as a citizen, expecting to get some kind of help from these courts. No, they're just there to prey on me further, as right. I come to find out.
Right, which is our purpose. Our purpose is to evidence them.
And you know, in the evidence I was putting in, that you would think that they would see, but no, thanks to stare decisis and attorney work product doctrine and all these things that the attorney has created to keep evidence off the court record, no, they're not looking at that. They're looking at the surety. They're looking at who is on the hook to offset this congressional bankruptcy, and that's all you are. You're being trafficked on paper by these judges, all right? Throwing you, you know, in an act of human trafficking, throwing you on paper, and they're depositing you, and they're cashing in on everything you're trying to do, okay? And this is what you're calling the justice system. Nothing could be further from the truth. I put in hundreds of papers of documents showing, you know, how this woman had embezzled from me and got into my bank accounts, cleaned me out, ran off with the kids, all right, left me with, you know, tens of thousands of credit card debts, let alone the mortgage with no money to pay it. So I soon found myself facing foreclosure. Now, I got, you know, the credit cards basically handled statutorily. Little did I know then, though, that they were just already planning on setting me up, you know, down the road for this foreclosure. All right. Now I come into court and arguing the foreclosure, and I had all their forensics and, you know, all the statutory curtains that they pull over on everybody, the dead man's pledge, you know, and I come up against this attorney, basically as a third party debt collector. Turns out this attorney is he's corporate counsel. So not only do I have a specialized government agent ex-wife, but you know, I'm dealing with corporate counsel attorney here in my foreclosure. Okay. All right, so you can't really explain this stuff and do it justice. You have to really experience it. Okay. Well, what we did is we did experience it, you know, and I finally divested all title, removed my stock from the United States, Inc., you know, I found out, you know, what an ongoing battle that is. It's like, no, you can't do that. You're, you know, get back in there and be a good surety is basically what I was being told. All right. Now, I said, no, well, I'm not going to be party to this anymore. I'm divesting all stock, revesting in my own house. Tam, you want to maybe fill in some holes here? I'm just seeing red, and I'm thinking about, you know, going back in my mind through these times.
Absolutely. And as a surety can only be a natural person. So if you're claiming to be a natural person, you're not a surety. And so often, you know, we learn through the evidence that you don't do that. Okay, so as Bo went along, and this is before he and I met and everything else, you know, he's saying, I want my rights. I'm a man. I'm a living being. Come on, hear me. Well, the presumption of death is already overcome upon the summon. Well, guess what? Vanessa files for divorce. Everybody files for divorce. Everybody gets summoned. Everybody's dead. They're on the same playing field. Okay? So then the foreclosure happens. The foreclosure is founded on what? A dead pledge, mortgage. And so all of these things are overcoming the presumption of death and allowing Congress to discharge congressional bankruptcy through the use of 28 U.S.C. subsection 453, which is the judicial oath to discharge congressional bankruptcy. They're discharging their duties under that oath. And their duties are what? Well, they're supposed to be paying back their bankruptcy, unless they can bring you in there and declare you dead. So when you started coming in as the beliving, you began with, don't post me. Don't post me. You know, here, you're trying to mail the dead thing again, and we're not going to have any of that. And so that corporate counsel attorney comes in, and this is at the local level in Superior Court. He comes in and he says, I'm going to keep on posting you. He does this on record. I'm going to keep on posting you. He doesn't argue 1794 Treaty of Amity, Commerce, or Navigation. He doesn't have any evidence providing that he can do that. And he continues to post him. Well, so we come back at him and we say, no, you're not going to post me. I'm not in your system. I'm not a citizen. I'm not anything you're trying to call me. Well, when we came back at him, and this is outside of court, this is only through us, you know, communicating through the court in on the record. And you can see this at chooseyourside.org or tammypepperman.org. All of the documentation is there. And you can start, you know, September of 2012. And it goes along. And, okay, don't post me. We were on that. We went off on him. We misspelled his name several times. So he came in to defend his title. Now, here's a corporate counsel attorney. Corporate counsel sitting in the local county. And it appears like they're just there for the county because, you know, counties are not the federal state, according to the 1802 Enablement Acts, beginning with the 1802 Enablement Acts. Well, we misspelled this guy's name several times in the document, so he comes in to defend the title, and he comes in as the federal state. That was
when we moved to...
Before we moved to district court.
Okay, before we moved to district court, right.
Right. So he comes in as a federal state, and he admits that he's working on behalf of the federal state, on behalf of Congress. Okay? So then we go along a little bit further, and he admits all of these things. So we come in and we say, no, okay, if you work for the federal state, we're going to call this out as a fraudulent assignment according to Article 1, Section 8, Clauses 1 and 2 of the Constitution, which maintains that human beings are to be kept on general welfare. It's not to be a corporate welfare setting in any way, shape, or form. Okay, so, and I'll stop here and remind everybody, if anybody in Congress or at the federal level or all these teachers and all these cops want to know who to blame, who threw it, who crapped the bed, It was Andrew P. Stewart. He came in to defend his title and throw it all away on behalf of the federal state, because at that time he admitted that the federal state, by his works and actions, were human trafficking and nothing more. Okay, so we go along. Now the bank stops mid-December after this is done. This is, well, towards the end of December, I guess it was around Christmas time. And they stop moving. They know what their liability is, right, as the bank. Well, the bank is in actuality the court, as defined by Black's Law Dictionary. And so they stop. And then in January, we start getting eviction notices. Notices to get out of the property because they're in a hurry now. These eviction notices are not coming from the bank. They're coming from David Chaplot, the judge sitting in the Superior Court.
The alleged judge. He's no judge at all by his works and actions.
Right, he's an attorney. So then, going along after these eviction notices, of course, this is a point where I threw myself under the bus because I had already done the my expatriation, which is more formal than expatriation. I actually did the hostile takeover of the franchise, and at that time I gave it to Bo. And what that means is that we came in with standing on December 14th, 2012. And for anybody who listens to us, you realize what that means, but I'll stop there and go back. At the, it wasn't the separation, it was the coronation charter. At the coronation charter, the king came in and took my estate, the female. And at that time, he says, well, I'm going to hold on to this just in case your husbands are dead, blah, blah, blah. Then they killed off all the husbands. And ever since that time, the quote, king has been holding the female's estate. Not the males, the female's. And as
and is there any question why the female's estate is, you know, and her rights are reserved over the males? Right. I should answer it right there.
Right, because she's chattel. She's used as a product.
By the king. He's right. The king's chattel.
Right.
The male is just a disposable, you know, competition to that king, so he wants to off you as quickly as possible.
Right. And you're the dead man that's lost at sea in the 1666 accessory caveat. So, when that female's estate is taken over, that was all of the estates merged into one throughout time. Throughout forever. And so, when Bo took me over, after I gave of myself, that means that everybody's estates were secured under Bo as the United States of being. So I already knew this, and Bo and I talked about this. Now I have the utmost trust. This is what Jesus teaches in 1 Corinthians 13, faith, hope, and charity. And I already knew what the court was going to do, and I already know what Bo was going to do because I trust him. So I went ahead and I went upon a motion. I didn't enter into the jurisdiction. I went upon a motion to for a restraint. What did I come in as? Injunctive relief.
Yeah, injunctive relief based on the 2009 Protecting Tenants Against Foreclosure Act.
Right.
Their own goddamn laws.
Right, which is all bullshit, right? Because when I came in, I'm actually not a tenant of the bank in any way, shape, or form. I'm a tenant of Bo, based on my forgiveness and executor doc. That's a trust relationship, and so I actually reside in that trust. So I went ahead and do that, knowing that Bo was going to pull me out. Now, the next part, you know, is part of 1 Corinthians 13, and so I already knew what the court was going to do, and sure enough, this attorney in the black dress represented my word. I went on an injunctive, upon a motion for injunction, and he gave me a temporary stay on the writ of
execution.
Writ of assistance.
Writ of assistance.
Right. So he completely represented my
That's
word.
A nice way of describing a writ, means to kick you the fuck out onto the street.
Right, right. But this is also the funny part, although it wasn't funny at the time. So, in return, of course, Bull writes him a letter as the executor, and he says, what the hell are you doing? You re-presented her word, and they called me what they call everybody else, proper person. They said I appeared in my proper person and all this. I did no such thing, as I'm already maintained as a state of being in my forgiveness and executor docs. And
so Bull, they had.
Yep. Bull wrote him a letter back channel.
So the judge was with, or the so-called judge, Chaplot, is with knowledge.
Absolutely. Well, and what most don't realize, because, you know, that's like a card kept on our hands, is that the bank never showed up that day. Okay, so this is failure to prosecute. Well, we knew all of these things prior to this. So Bull writes the judge a letter and says, this is executor de centaure, yada yada. You can find this in the documents. Which, of course, pissed the judge off. Pissed him off. It says Bo has authority and you don't have authority. And this judge reacted accordingly. He kicked us out immediately. 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 He didn't wait for anything. He just whipped his little pecker out and showed us. And that was the most profound thing, is that the judge was acting as the bank.
Yeah, this, mind you, is when we had already entered into the United States District Court.
Absolutely.
Which, by their own laws, once again, all that Superior Court stuff, lower court action, is supposed to halt immediately.
Absolutely.
They don't care about that.
No, we already knew what they were going to do, because that's what Jesus directs us to do in 1 Corinthians 13. Experience all things so that you can get the evidence to hold them accountable. And that's what we were doing. So we're in district court at the same time we're being kicked out of the house and everything else. And in district court, we put in the, you know, you can see it on the docs. Just go to the docs. I'm not going to get into a bunch of details. So here I am preyed on. Okay.
Yeah, before you even left the court that day, don't forget that that judge had sicked some sicko adult protection services guy to accost you,
right,
as you were trying to scurry out the house of Ball.
Right, and that was another funny aspect that we were able to evidence. So in between, as we're fighting this, they're hitting us from all sides with fortune, rage, and warfare. And so we were telling the gas company, don't post me. Now, the gas company, of course, is involved in all of this. That is the corporate governance. The Sesame K Trusts are actually set up in utility companies.
That's right. You people out there want to know where your money from your estate's being hidden. It's being held in those utilities companies. And you can see this from Massachusetts Land Trust document.
Right. That I should probably... Declarations of trust is substitutes for incorporation. Now, those are declarations, and, you know, I wish
I should probably put those up so people can get those too.
Right. Well, a declaration,
so they can see how they've been scammed.
Right. A declaration is something said. It's not something done. It's not physical. It's still a fiction. So they can declare their trust all they want to, but their trusts are always a fictional character of a trust, which is called fiduciary. So regardless, again, they don't have any standing. So the gas company, what they did was they shut off the gas first. And, of course, I'm not in their system. I'm a separate country than they are under my forgiveness and executor docs. And so they had perpetrated war crimes against my country. So I put that in the court. We put that in the court because, you know, they're perpetrating criminal acts. And we turned back. We turned the gas back on, or it appeared to be back on. Anyway, so then they came out and they told the entire gas meter thing. And
so this is in the middle of winter.
In the middle of winter. So, and that's the reason that when I was in court that day, they sicked adult protection on me. This guy came up to me and offered to. He said, "Honey, are you having any difficulties?" And I'm like, "No, I'm fine." He says, "Do you need cash assistance? We can give you cash. I can set you up in a new house. I can do all of these things." Well, that's the action of hearts and minds. That's a war tactic in order to divide me from the male. And for all intents and purposes, for, you know, that's under a trust agreement, that's a union. So their function, that snake in the garden, his function is to divide the male and the female so that I can be preyed on by offering me those benefits. Anyway, so it took me about 10, 15 minutes to get out of there and get away from this guy because he's very persistent. And of course, I'm you know, no, I'm fine. Leave me alone. And he kept coming back at me. Do you need this? And I'll offer you this. And
he gets financial assistance, or he gets financial incentives, rather, for perpetuating these things, you know, so many signups. It's a piecemeal thing, I'm sure.
Absolutely. Federal drawing rights, special drawing rights, sorry, and treasury funds for helping the female under feminism. And no, I didn't contract with them. I declined all of their offers because I'm not about to go away from the male. I have no intentions of contracting with the snake in the garden. So I get out of there, yada, yada. We eventually get, you know, evicted. The sheriff comes out, armed to the teeth, all of these things. I don't remember. There was like three of them there. And then this dancing real estate agent. And, you know, since that time, he killed one of the cats. He Grand Theft Auto on the Jimmy, which is still ongoing, which is the funny part, you know. And during the time that we were retrieving this things from this property, you know, I looked this guy in the face and I said, look, I've never lost a case. I never intend on losing a case. And eventually you're going to be held accountable, but you're going to be used as a fall guy because you're the one that we see. You know, these are all presentations put on by the marquee. Well, he doesn't listen to me. He laughs and he made his money and everything else. And, you know, and then eventually we had so many cases going on at that point in time. It wasn't only ours. We were evidencing that they're preying on children, preying on females in between, and we're doing all of these things, and of course, Bo's busier than any of us. And that's what happened in March. So we get to March here. March 5th, the International Monetary Fund was given evidence, not only of the evidence they were preying on me as a female, they were preying on children, they were preying on other females as well, and they got that evidence. And by the 8th, the United States Incorporated was voluntarily withdrawn from the International Monetary Fund based on their works and actions, because they weren't using the special drawing rights to protect females. They were using special drawing rights to prey on them and children.
And you want evidence of this, again, go to the Dropbox link to chooseyourside.org, tammypepperman.org, go to the documents page and pull up the IMF screenshots.
Right. So then it starts getting exciting. Okay, this judge now, we're dealing with, what was his name in district?
Simon.
Simon.
Yeah. Simon says.
Yeah,
Simon Bar Sinister.
Simon was funny. So he came in. There was no motion from anybody to dismiss that was a valid motion to dismiss, because it came from corporate counsel. It came from corporate counsel in South Bend, Indiana, the St. Joseph County. And they came in and solidified the judgment at that time by appearing on behalf of St. Joseph County. And what that is a cognitive judgment. So we won the judgment then. Then we go along and we, of course, overruled Simon several times because he wasn't adhering to any law. He wasn't maintaining that he had any authority whatsoever. And he couldn't be a judge. He wasn't acting as a judge. And so we kept slamming him down for that. And eventually the company corporation came in on appearance with their attorneys, which was a cognitive judgment against the corporation, the company corporation. Northern Holdings came in on appearance of their attorney, which was a cognitive judgment against Northern Holdings. By May, we had the agreed entry with Northern Holdings. We issued that agreed entry. It was never argued by the bank, court, or anybody else. United States Incorporated. And all of this time, of course, we're following the rules of service and everything else. Senate was served. They opened theirs, their summon, and upon opening it, they sealed it back up with tape, said open for inspection, and attempted to send it back, as did the company corporation, but we already had receipt that they had received it. And these are the funny things, is that, you know, that just doesn't happen. You know, it's just...
Yeah, explain for our listeners that may not know who the company corporation is.
That's the one with all of the utilities stuck into it as a holding corporation.
Yes.
And so, and this is all under Northern Holdings. Now, there's lots and lots and lots of holding corporations and everything else, but Northern Holding has no parent company. It is the father of all of the others. So it holds the medical industry, it holds the criminal industry, it holds the insurance, it holds everything. And everybody is under Northern Holding, which is, of course, the Geneva 8, Geneva 28, all of these things are in line with Northern Holdings. That is what that is. It's the International Association of Corporations there, because they've been bankrupt since 1933, and Congress has global governance since 1941 in the Atlantic Charter. So we, you know, all of these things, again, they can be read in all of the documents as they go through. They're in line with everything that occurred in between. You know, we were doing Chris's case in Minnesota, and we came in as the United States in that case as well. And when we did, we said, look, this appears to be, at that time we were saying, this is appearing to be a child sex trafficking ring. You know, you're facilitating these things. These things were never argued. And the most profound aspect of that was the court came back at Chris and said, well, if you want us to do anything, you're going to have to denounce the House of Alsop and say that you're not a citizen of the House of Alsop or the United States. And in a court order. Now, in that judgment, the foreign judgment is solidified by the cognizant judgment, of course. And that female's attorney came in, of course, and asked that state for a restraining order, all of these things. But she had solidified that judgment against Minnesota, against that county, Kearns County, all of these things. And again, that was part of the evidence that was provided the International Monetary Fund May, June. And, you know, of course, we're doing other things, you know, back channel throughout time. But those are some of the little details of, in a nutshell, I guess. There was a lot more that was occurring. The theft of the Jimmy, killing of the cat, killing of the fish. All of the fish were murdered by this guy. The most disgusting things, but again, it's relative to the implication of fourth generation warfare. It's all pressure. All of the pressure is provided by the corporate governance, by the agents and actors employed by the corporate governance. And so all of this time, you know, it's intended to break us. That's its intent. Low intensity conflict is to maintain, to force you, coerce you into consenting to their authority. And again, I already know they're a criminal enterprise. I'm not going to consent with these idiots, you know. And that's something that they don't realize, because since the separation of the spiritual and temporal, way, way back when, the male and the female have been separated. They've been allowing interference by the state. She's been running off through use of advertisement to go and consent for on behalf of him, which is another aspect of the facilitation or action of matrimony, giving all things to the mother. The male was never allowed to hold any estate ever. If he survived her in marriage, he could garner what is known as courtesy estate, but only if they had children. So it was passing to the children, and of course this only passes to the female children. because she is the estate. And, you know, the male's been set up as, you know, whatever, whatever heir, but he hasn't existed as the heir until December 14, 2012, when I gave the estate to the male, knowing without a doubt that he was going to hold on to it on behalf of all of humanity, and without a doubt that he would continue to protect us and continue to facilitate that trust or that union, and allowing the United States of being to have standing. Now, what needs to be, you know, realized here is that Congress came in with letters patent, kings come in with letters patent, and they say, well, I described you, so I am the patent holder on this thing, I'm the one with the benefits. And by consent, that was being facilitated, but it never had a foundation in the physics. On December 14, 2012, the United States actually had physical property in their hands, the same property that Congress has been maintaining they own, the same property that the king said he owned, went to the male, which allowed the United States of being every and all standing ability, because it's the only one with property.
So we have all these shoes out there that are telling you come get aboard their ship, because they're going to show you how to find the remedy, which involves pleading in these courts of ball, which are not courts, but they're business places. These are places of business, folks. Guys are looking for relief and remedy through these corporations calling themselves courts. And you wonder why you're not getting justice. Okay? Well, you're not going to get justice in this manner, because the most you can ever even hope for is 0.82%, as Tammy's been teaching under the... that's with the...
Debenture Participation Program, or under the CUSIP number. CUSIP bonds.
Yep. The CUSIP bonds. So, you have to really wonder about what all these other people are pushing, and why now that they're coming on even stronger. You would think that some of these guys that were more into the esoteric type ideas of law and ancient law and things like that would get this. And again, I'm thinking they do, but they've got another function. And, you know, that is to be a saboteur, okay, or what I like to call a shoe. We've got the cure. We've got the cure right here, and...
all the world's at your fingertips. You have standing. You own the property, thanks to Bo. Bo didn't hold on to the property and say, well, this is mine. He came into the United States District Court as the United States of being. Now, the whole United States across the globe, every human being owns that property, that land, that estate.
That's right, and that's exactly what I want. I want human beings to have property. I want them to have their houses. I want them to have their ability to just be, to grow their own food, to raise their families without the interference of this federal state. Let's call it for what it is. It's a confederacy that's constantly siphoning off your wealth and killing you. I've had it. I've seen relatives in previous generations come out of wars, you know, messed up because of the psychological damage. I mean, they were lucky in the sense that they came back with all their limbs, most of them. But the psychological damage and trauma lasts the rest of their lives. Okay, and what were they doing it for? They were doing it for the offsetting of congressional bankruptcy for Congress.
Garnering new citizens by taking over new countries, new peoples. And these things, you know, that's a, Vietnam was a creation of the CIA. The CIA went in there and was on the ground providing the artificial intelligence by which to facilitate war. Korean War was the same thing. Japanese War, Syrian War, Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan. This is all CIA infiltrating that country and promoting artificial intelligence to you to say, well, there's a civil war. We need to kill some people to get rid of this civil war. They're the ones that are causing these things. Those citizens are the same as you and I. They're just sitting there in their houses and they're like, oh my God, there's a civil war going on. We need help. Help me, help me. And they call on their government, which is in treaty agreement with the United States Incorporated, as the United States Incorporated, to discharge congressional bankruptcy. By how? Low intensity conflict, fourth generation warfare, offering them hearts and minds. Oh, you guys are hurting here. I have a Department of Health and Human Services, and we can offer you food stamps and housing benefits and social security programs and welfare benefits and stuff.
Come on. And all that stuff that you would probably need in the first place if the attorneys hadn't taken them off you in the first place.
Right. You didn't need welfare before that because you could grow your own freaking food, raise your own farm, raise your own family. Nobody was interceding in your estate. You already owned that property. It was yours. Before you gave it up by patronizing the same thing that's attacking you and killing you. Now, they don't know any better, right? They don't speak English. They've got a whole bunch of English-speaking people there that are teaching them English and saying, I'm the good guy. I'm the nice guy. Here's some welfare benefits. And what happened with the Malaysians when that happened? Well, you covered that story. Hearts and Minds, the term, the definition came about when the Britain entered into the Malaysian population, garnered the females by offering them medical and food aid. And what happened this year, there was this woman that you had reported on that had a baby that she couldn't see because she was kept as a political prisoner 23 hours a day. She could get out 1 hour a day to go see her baby because she had accepted welfare benefits. She was imprisoned.
Yeah. Yeah, there's just another video of mine that got maybe 300 hits or something like that. I don't know. I guess
people think that if they ignore it, it's going to go away. It's not going away. It's right on top of you. You are in the war. You are inside of the war. You just don't feel it because it's sold to you as low intensity conflict. You've got CPS here, you've got the courts, you've got everything else offering you all of these little trinkets, little tiny things that you're trading your soul for. You're selling your soul every time you put a signature down on those documents and say, yes, I'm going to assign somebody to pay this off for me, or I'm going to pledge myself, or whatever else. That's the action of selling your soul. That's the bag of silver that Judas or Withlaw is offered.
And these same people are the ones that are going to stomp their feet and say, I want my constitutional rights.
And you're getting them. You are being killed equally. Just as much as your neighbor is being killed. You have equal rights to be murdered. You have equal rights to be raped. You have equal rights, and your children have equal rights to be molested by judges, psychiatrists, and attorneys. You have the same right as anybody else to be killed by the medical industry, to be driven insane by fourth-generation warfare or the psychological industry, or to be criminalized just like your neighbor. You have equal rights to your neighbor to be criminalized, to discharge congressional bankruptcy. You're all created equal as fictions.
And if you need a little more prodding, Okay, they got corporate counsel attorneys directing them cops to go rough you up a bit, pull you over for a headlight out, turn that into a search and seizure, throw you in jail, and maybe kill you for a $96 fine. That's your benefits. This all ends when you people stop purchasing your law from these psychopaths.
Revelation 18. When you stop fornicating, when you, the whore of Babylon, stop fornicating, as defined in 1 Corinthians 6, you can only fornicate by giving your body over to the Lord God or an owner of it. When you stop fornicating, Babel falls. And that's when the law merchants wail. And that's why we see all of these agents now whining and crying. And you can go to any one of our YouTube videos and you'll find an agent there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Most everybody that comments is an agent.
It's just so profound to watch how they're wailing. They're crying. They don't want this to happen.
We had an attorney yesterday on one of them telling me to quit calling it the public law.
Yeah. No, we got to go back to the natural law, she says.
Yeah, common law.
Yeah, only...
She threw common law and natural law in there together.
Right. The surety is the natural person. Only a natural person can be a surety.
Common law is communism.
Absolutely.
Case law. See case precedents.
Yep. 1938 stare decisis.
Which says basically, well, we ruled this way before in another case. So this is where we're ruling your case. Next.
Yep. That's it. It's communism. It's redistribution of the individual or individualism. We're going to lump all of these rights together in a group. And we have to find this way because of that group. And that's what redistributes the individual created by constitutional theory. If you claim to be an individual, you're not filled up with your soul. You're filled up with the Constitution. What somebody else tells you that you consist of. That's what a constitution is. Now they're calling you a thing. This is the rights that go with this thing. These are the rights that go with that thing. These are the rights that go with that thing. That thing is called arrest, R-E-S. That means thing. So when you're providing to them that you're a resident, you're a thing. If you're claiming to be an individual, you're filled up with constitutional theory. A fiction. It's a theory. And you're buying into this and walking around as fictions. What does that mean? 1666 says 3K Viax says you're lost at sea. You have no idea who you are at all. And until you're the dead man, come back from being lost at sea, which is exactly what it says, then you're forever dead. And you can overcome the presumption of death. 28 U.S.C. subsection 108. No. 38 U.S.C. subsection 108, sorry, is the 7-year absence presumption of death. Well, you're presumed to be lost and dead, but they can't declare you dead until you admit it. How do you admit it? When you receive a summon in the mail, they're summoning the dead. If you accept that and answer it, you're answering as the dead. When you sign a mortgage, that's a dead pledge. You're overcoming the presumption that you're dead. At that time, you're saying, I'm dead. Now you need to come back from the Sea of Commerce. Same sea that Jesus walked on. He walked on water. He walked on top of the Sea of Commerce. He didn't stick his feet in that. He didn't play their games. He went off on them. Stop swimming around in the Sea of Commerce. Once you're above the Sea of Commerce and you're walking on water, you can hold them accountable and ring that millstone around their neck and allow them to drown in the Sea of Commerce. Because they're a fictional creation just as much as you were. An attorney is more so. It even has a pretend government, an imaginary government. A court, a judge. Those bankers, they have a fictional employer. that doesn't exist. The judge is the bank. The attorneys are the bank.
And they're all in the same good old boys club. Many of them will be down at the golf course, playing golf together. District attorneys, judges, attorneys, probably chief of police, sheriffs. Okay, might even be in the same Masonic lodge together. Okay, they're the good old boys club, and they're going to protect each other. Okay, where does that leave you, the citizen? Under the bus with the wheels spinning.
Well, and that conversation that you put up for me on your wall, that I had had with the marshals and law enforcement and everything else, and I'm trying to tell them I was never served by the bank. The bank does not have legs or arms. It has no humanity whatsoever. It's a fiction. It's a concept in the mind, created in the mind. The bank does not exist. Attorneys exist. Attorneys are colorful titles for beings, entities holding those titles, adhering to a fictional government. But you're not dealing with bank. A bank doesn't have arms and legs. It cannot walk up to my door and serve me anything. The bank is represented by attorneys and judges and sheriffs, law enforcement. And that's something that we have the hardest time with, you know, everybody being able to hear us, is that the bank does not exist. It is attorneys, only attorneys. The bank is owned by attorneys. The court is owned by attorneys. All of these things.
Congress is run by attorneys.
Yes. These are general counsel.
General counsel attorneys.
Board of directors. Corporate counsel.
Eric Holder.
All of these things are just attorneys. You look at a corporation, Walmart, who runs it? Attorneys. Sears, attorneys. Turner Broadcasting, attorneys. Comcast, attorneys. Google, attorneys.
Who have you always been told to go to when you got legal troubles? Go get an attorney.
Absolutely.
They teach you that from, you know, the Matlock back in whatever.
Absolutely, because he was such a good guy. First, he was Andy Griffith. You have to go from the inception of indoctrination to the extension. So you have Andy Griffith is just this good boy sheriff, and he's so wondrous, wondrous. And then he's even more wondrous than as an attorney, and he's facilitating, quote, court that never existed. Never existed. That's a concept. A court, if there was an actual court, it would be bound by a judge, bound by judicial canon, according to just that concept alone. Those things never existed. They're banks. And part of the indoctrination process is convincing the human mind to take up these concepts and believe they exist. And that's what happened to God in the garden. The Lord God said, well, I'm creating man. I'll just name it Adam. Adam means man. That's a concept. Stole God a bunch of concepts and taught God that he was not. And that's the point we're at now, is you've got Satan, your adversary, telling you that you're not God. You don't have any authority because their fiction trumps you, the reality. Now, how does that make sense? You know, you talk about the golden calf. What the heck is fictional governments? Fictional religion? Fictional churches? Church means a group of people. All of these fictional things that are developed and groomed in the mind to appear in the mind to exist. That's called imagination. You not only have imaginary friends, you have an imaginary government, imaginary corporations, imaginary structures. They don't exist.
And in these critters' minds, they have more significance than a human life.
Absolutely. That was the intent of the 14th Amendment. The clergy for Congress, Abraham Lincoln, came in and redefined what life is. The person is a corporation.
Well, the irony of it is, with the example of Fukushima, they've breathed life into this leviathan, this tentacle known as TEPCO, who is now, what is now, in the process of exterminating, I don't know how many millions of people over the next 300, 400 years until this mess is cleaned up. All right? This is why we got to stop this now. I mean, if you allow this to go on, you're going to have more corporations getting away with this stuff, all protected by their limited liability corporation structure and attorneys reserving that fictional corporation rights over yours.
Which is corporatism. Now, for every corporation that thinks they're untouchable, or for every employee of the corporation, because of course they're run by attorneys, I have news for you. Environmentalism redistributes corporatism. It's a means and mechanism, just as much as feminism is using the court process to redistribute the male.
You could think of it as in the terms of the fictional border lines the attorneys set up, you know, United Statesism and Canadaism.
Right.
Got Russianism and Ukrainianism.
Right, but they're all internal structures of the creative fiction. Mm-hmm. You know, all of these things. The corporation as a person is the equivalent to the individual created by constitutional theory. Well, the individual is redistributed through communism, case law, common law, which is feminism and racism. Those things are communal things, communism, that lump people together in groups by which to redistribute the individual. Now, environmentalism is like the big feminism, the big racism, the big Judaism, the big Catholicism, the big Zionism. That thing is intended to wipe out the corporations as the individual, the created person. And that's the most profound thing to see, because inside of environmentalism, what do you have to redistribute the corporations? Feminism, racism. And so they're being pulled apart from the inside out. And these are not run by human beings. Citizens work for them. And some citizens benefit by playing into the stock market. But these corporations are being taken apart on purpose by attorneys, because attorneys benefit. Now everybody's watching how Microsoft is being nailed again for, you know, insider trading and all these things. Microsoft sits on the Association of Corporate Counsel. It is the general counsel, so it's redistributing itself. And who suffers? The stockholders and people who work for Microsoft. Who gets paid? The attorneys playing this game, which is insider trading, the same thing that they're charging Microsoft for. Because it's the attorney that owns the corporation there. Please, please, please wrap your mind around this cartoon, because it's going to come down to the point where it's hurting everybody. And at that point, it is Nazi Germany, and everybody can't scream out because they're actually in chains. Just recently, we saw the geoengineering that created havoc and hell down in Georgia and Alabama. Okay, so everybody was put into fear. Now, they're expecting a little bit more snow here coming soon. And so they have the National Guard on ready, on standby. That is the FEMA camp that you guys have been waiting for. It's already there. Okay, you guys went into fear. You guys can't drive or shit in the wintertime. 2 inches of snow, idiots. You killed each other.
Because you're in a hurry to get to your job.
Yes, you're in a hurry to do everything but protect humanity. 2 inches of snow, has a National Guard on ready, on standby. That is a FEMA camp. That's called urban pacification. You said, oh no, my bottle's gone, give me my pacifier. Enough is enough.
The devil is down in Georgia.
Enough is enough. I mean, these things are disgusting. And if you want to know what's going to happen to you, those of you that have accepted this and consented to these things, and you went out driving like nuts, the Red Cross is a holding facilitation or mechanism by which to pick up prisoners of war. 1864 Geneva Convention. Every time you hotline that 911 to come save you because you were so stupid. And I'm not going to apologize for that one. 2 inches of snow. I've lived in the mountains. I've lived everywhere. I don't drive like an idiot. I'm never in a hurry because I'm always considering human beings. And yet you were gridlocked. You were absolutely, disgustingly killing each other because you had to hurry, because you have to get this done, and you have to get this done. And children were left in schools overnight.
And you have to get to the time clock and punch that time clock on time, you know, so you can pay your taxes.
But you're the
most
important.
Keep your job, pay your taxes, keep paying those debt notes that are basically backed by your own earning potential.
But you're the most important. You are the living being. Your corporation that you work for is a fiction. You sent your kids to school that day, and they spent overnight in the Hitler youth camps away from you. Because of your inactions and your actions. And now so many are stuck into the prison camps through the operation of the Red Cross, through the operation of FEMA, through the operation of the governor that's over FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Acts. Those things are not to fix the roads. Those are means and mechanisms of garnering you into institutionalized states. Go look at your state's emergency rules. Go look at what their emergency states of being are. That's you. You've got to stop allowing Governor Pilate to confiscate you. We're going to take a break real quick. And we're back. And you're listening to After Hours with Bo and Tami right here on thesechangingtimes.com. Again, we are a listener-supported radio station. Wondering if you'd like to donate, just go to the homepage. And over on the right, you'll see a donate button. Every little bit helps. It helps Patty keep us on the air, as she's already expanded to do so. But was going to get, I know we've been talking about a lot of the crap that's going on, but we do have hope, and Bo wants to go into the what he dubs the Attorney Surety Roundup, which I love listening to on the Bo and Rocko Show. And so I'll just give it to you.
Well, before I go into all that, first of all, we're not anarchists. We do have a law, okay? We call it the public law because it has to do with harm against a public vessel, which is usually human beings. And it's basically, you have a choice. That's why we named the website chooseyourside.org, okay? And under the public law, it says to do no harm, okay? Under their private acts and acts of commerce, that they're selling you as a law. You got 6 million codes, statutes, regulations, policy, all this stuff that you're expected to know, because ignorance of the law is no excuse, because they've published it publicly, you know, for you to read. So you're just expected to know all these things. All right, we're not expecting you to know that here. Okay, under the public law system, there's a do no harm. Okay, and if you perpetrate harm upon a human being, you will be held accountable. That's the name of the game. And so, why so many want to come back and sell the law merchants' laws over ours is highly suspicious. Because it's just, it's just common sense. Absolutely. What the attorneys are ramming down your throats is not common sense. It's for them to profiteer off you.
And the medical industry, you know, a bit back, I had covered lethal injection and the use of these medications. And of course, the shoe comes on and she calls me insane. And then at the very end of our conversation, you know, I'm giving her the evidence of these things and showing her how the United States Incorporated kills human beings. You know, I didn't get into the contracts with the FDA and the Ethics Commission, but she comes back finally at the end, trying to maintain title, and she says, I'm in the medical industry. And I said, you know, short and sweet, I already knew that. The only entity that defends genocide would be the perpetrator of genocide. And it's the same as any entity that defends rape or defends somebody being kidnapped. They have profit in rape. They have profit in kidnapping. They have profit in human trafficking. That is the only reason that they're defending those things. Not because they're stupid. It's because they're agents. And they have interest in these things occurring against human beings.
All right. So, to give you yet again another glimpse on the writing of the wall for the shape of things to come, that have come right here and now. We've got the new surety being held at Northern, right? That means they have to use the attorney to offset congressional bankruptcy. So, for this so-called judge that issued this order to have Rocko arrested and now holding him as a political prisoner, and make no mistake, he's a prisoner of war, because this is war, basically. Not basically, it is war, fourth generation and otherwise. Okay, attorneys would love nothing more than to get a civil war going, and they've been setting it up pretty good between the cops and the citizens so far. I've been covering that. Let's talk about some accountability for some of these attorneys. All right. Here's a quick one here from the Twin Cities. Lawyers accused of assault on driver. 64-year-old attorney was charged Monday with a gross misdemeanor and two misdemeanors after he allegedly assaulted a woman he encountered in St. Paul and called her racial slurs. Oh, yeah, I'm an attorney. I'll be able to do whatever I want. Okay. Get away with it, as you know, 64 years, let's see, 7 years of law school, so that means he was probably an attorney when he was 25 years old, okay? So, almost 40 years as an attorney getting away with this crap, all right? Officers were called at 9:54 p.m. Saturday and to Grand Avenue and Lexington Parkway. Siani Chan, 23, told police she was parked in front of Domino's Pizza with her sister and two children waiting for food. You know, which they probably had to scrape together on the budgets that the attorneys have allowed these people, all of us. When a man walked by her car and yelled something at her, the man later identified as Schulte, continued to yell and hit the hood of her car, the criminal complaint said. Chan got out, tried to stand between him and her car. Schulte punched her in the arm. He was also calling Ms. Chan, who is Asian, racial slurs loudly enough so that the others in the area heard him, the complaint said.
Now, this is interesting that this is being maintained in the mainstream media because of what had happened back at the introduction of the CIA production of the KKK. That was a legislator, Simmons. And in that, he came in and he says, we're all racist. Nobody saw that that was a legislator. Nobody saw that that was an attorney. And so everybody assumes, oh my gosh, there's racism. We need to pay more taxes to combat these things. And that's how they get you with hearts and minds. But now in the mainstream media, they're outing the racist. They're outing the criminal, which is an attorney, hating human beings and only viewing them as objects. That guy's an accountant. He likes human beings as much as he can count them in court. Sorry.
So Schulte was arrested at 11:45 p.m. Saturday at his apartment. According to a Ramsey County jail log, Schulte told police he was leaving a meeting and was angry because the vehicle Ms. Chan was occupying was parked far from the curb. Yeah, not complying to our codes and statutes that we have so diligently worked to set up for you citizens. And again, as a fiction, his rights have always been reserved over yours.
And who is belittling her to make her feel like a criminal.
He also admitted to calling her some silly racist things, but did not recall punching or pushing her, saying that he blacked out. Schulte, who is a criminal defense attorney, declined a Pioneer Press request for an interview made Monday through the jail. He was admitted to the Minnesota Bar in 1994, and no discipline is listed on his public record, according to the Minnesota Office of Lawyers Professional Responsibility website. Well, yeah, he's never been held accountable before.
He says he blacked out. So, you know, we need a psych eval. We need to make sure that, you know, he doesn't have something wrong with him, don't we?
That's right. Get him diagnosed.
Absolutely. We need to make sure he's competent to stand trial for these things and the whole gamut of attorney work product doctrine and every other aspect of the institutionalization of what the surety is. We need to get him diagnosed as soon as possible. Otherwise, how can we repair him according to Bonhomery bonds? He's been reborn. Hallelujah.
You'd probably have to hire an attorney, which is ironic justice there, isn't it?
Absolutely.
All right, over to the New York Post. Lawyer charged in resurrection of plunder plot at S.I. Cemetery. Okay, this is just hot February 10th, 2014. Lawyer named interim president of Staten Island Cemetery after its bookkeeper was nabbed in 2012 for defrauding the charity has been charged with continuing the theft.
Continuing the theft. So this attorney was put in there after the last attorney was stealing. Okay, now everybody who wants to recuse a judge and who wants to fire their attorney and hire a new one, read this case.
A lawyer who was put in charge of the Staten Island Cemetery that had been looted by its bookkeeper was busted Monday on charges of continuing the scam and stealing nearly $2 million more. Timothy Griffin, 54, allegedly made 6 unauthorized wire transfers from the United Hebrew Cemetery to his attorney escrow account between October 2012 and January 3rd. And signed a written confession admitting that he did it to fund his struggling Bronxville law firm.
Aww.
Assistant Attorney General Chin Ho Chang said in court. Griffin, who formerly served as the Boneyard's lawyer, was named acting president by its board following the ouster of ex-president Arthur Friedman and his wife, Leanda. According to the State Attorney General Office, Leanda Friedman pleaded guilty last year and was sentenced to probation for embezzling more than $850,000 from the not-for-profit cemetery while working as its bookkeeper.
Yeah, a nonprofit is 501c3, which is federally funded anyway. So, folks, everybody listen, they just stole your money, and they're saying that it was theirs.
Yeah, and listen what they use it for. You think that they use it to feed the poor or anything like that? No. This is how these psychopaths think. 30 said she used money to fund lavish purchases of jewelry, electronics, and restaurant meals, along with $9,000 she spent in Las Vegas while attending cemetery industry conventions there.
Aww. And isn't that something? Now, this cemetery, if you go back to Matthew 27, this is the charity that they founded, right? Those pauper cemeteries where they put the Judas's silver that he gave back to him. They couldn't put it back in the treasury because it was what? Blood money. So he's out gambling blood money. That's you, human being, being trafficked. While this attorney is out having a nice time, he's living high on the hog. And this is not the first attorney. This is the second attorney replacing the other criminal attorney.
Yep. So, isn't that just lovely? Let's see. Both she and her hubby also agreed to pay more than $1 million in restitution and were permanently barred from the funeral and ceremony or cemetery businesses. It's always sad and shocking when we discover that someone used a charity as their own personal piggy bank, Attorney General Eric Schneiderman said following Griffin's arrest. And this is the only one that hit the news. This, I guarantee you, everywhere there's an attorney involved, this kind of shit is going on.
They were permanently, read that again, they were permanently...
Permanently barred from the funeral and cemetery business.
Business. In general. So apparently they're going to be stuffed and mounted when they die? They have to go to like a taxidermist or something?
Yeah. Yeah, so... Alright, enough of that one. Cover some cops for you cops that still think you're immune. Let's see. This is some San Diego. SD officer Christopher Hayes arrested. San Diego police officer Christopher Hayes was arrested Sunday afternoon on suspicion of false imprisonment and misdemeanor sexual battery with four women. District Attorney's office is also investigating claims by two more women, make a total of six. Most of the cases involved claims that Hayes inappropriately touched women, all in their 20s or 30s. Yeah, not them 60-year-old women. He didn't accost them, did he? During pat-down searches of their bodies. Well, however, at a news conference Sunday afternoon, San Diego Police Chief Bill Lansdowne said that at least one of the two new cases involves more serious claims involving sexual contact that could involve felony charges. Okay, let's see. Hayes, 30 years old. Boy, his life is screwed now, isn't it? 30 years old. Okay, probably served in the war. He's already...
indoctrinated.
Well, I don't know. It doesn't say that, but generally, lots of officers in that age bracket did some time in the military services. So he surrendered Sunday at the sheriff's substation in Rancho Bernardo and was booked into the downtown jail at 1:30 p.m. And he's going to have a nice time in that jail with those people he's probably arrested. Some of them, you know.
Right.
Or just knowing that he's a cop.
Yep. And that's the attorney's intent. The attorney doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt the attorney. It doesn't hurt corporate counsel as they're discharging congressional bankruptcy.
He was booked on two counts of false imprisonment and three counts of misdemeanor sexual battery. Was later released on a $130,000 bond.
Where did he get that money at? He's a cop, a young cop.
Yeah, must have had some side deals, had it stashed somewhere.
Yep.
Or
his parents are now being redistributed on his behalf.
Yeah, they go after the family, too. If the district attorney charges Hayes with the counts that he was arrested on, police said he could face up to 7.5 years in prison.
That's hard time no matter what, because he's former law enforcement in there. You know, law enforcement needs to realize they're being rolled over, the corporate counsel, general counsel, board of directors, board of commissioners that commission you. And here it is, right in your faces. Judas, or the one with law, being politically cannibalized, which is political suicide. You're hanging yourselves.
Okay, so we got another one here. As soon as I get my computer to cooperate. Okay. TheMonitor.com. Customs officer accused of shooting girlfriend's brother in the face.
In the face?
Yep. McAllen, a U.S. Customs and Border Protection officer. Protection officer. Who's he protected? The finances of the state? Protection officer. Okay. Accused of shooting girlfriend's brother in the face. The apparent ending to a domestic dispute, police said. Yeah, that would just about end it, I would guess.
Sick.
On Friday evening, 41-year-old Randall Wayne Sutterfield went before a McAllen municipal judge who formally charged him with criminal attempted murder.
A municipal judge?
Yeah.
Normally, they don't have that jurisdiction. Are they going to try to get out on a technicality? We'll have to watch that one and make sure.
Yeah, it's interesting. Police officers responded to the shooting shortly after 2:30 a.m. at the 5400 block of North 15th Street and said McAllen Police Chief Victor Rodriguez, the suspect had already left the scene, Rodriguez said. Red crime scene tape lined the entrance of the North McAllen apartment complex, where emergency responders rushed a man with a gunshot wound to the head to a local hospital. Investigators were able to identify Sutterfield and notify other agencies to help look for him. That led to U.S. Border Patrol agents arresting Sutterfield at the Falfurrias checkpoint as he tried to leave the Rio Grande Valley, the chief said.
Wow, so he's trying to run Mexico.
Yeah.
It's not a good idea, Border Patrol.
The CBP officer was formally charged with criminal attempted murder at a Friday evening arraignment in McAllen Municipal Court. Bond was set at $750,000 on the second degree felony charge.
Wow.
He was set to be transferred to Hidalgo County Jail. If convicted, he faces between 2 and 20 years in prison and up to $10,000 in fines. Okay?
A human life is worth $10,000.
Yeah. I mean, here they are. They're still charging them rent and stuff. But, okay, that's their laws. I don't care what laws they use on them, as long as they're taken out and held accountable.
Absolutely. I don't like the catch and release to 20 years, because he'll just get out and do it again. And after he spends some time in prison and everybody kicks the shit out of him, because he's an ex-cop, he's going to get his ass kicked over and over and over again, unless he puts himself in segregation, which is what narcs do. And as everybody knows who knows any of the lingual or language of the prison industry, you know, a narc who goes into segregation is also going to get their ass kicked. So he's looking forward to a really nice, quote, vacation, 2 to 20 year vacation. However, that allows him to be festered too. And I don't like the catch and release. And if you, you know, realize these things, please, please come to the other side. Choose your side. It's happening right now. Anybody who could maintain that a concept is more important than a human being, especially for these attempted murders and everything else, you've got to realize that there's nothing more important than the human being. No more catch and release. Compassionate justice is the way to go. They need to be away from humanity or the ability to interact with humanity after they've been evidenced to commit such things, perpetrate such things.
Okay, so here the chief is trying to play the good guy. We don't tolerate corruption or abuse within our ranks, and we will fully cooperate with any criminal or administrative investigation. Following the Friday evening arraignment, Sutherfield's mother, Darren McLean, arrived outside McAllen Municipal Court late to see her son go before the judge. She said she doesn't believe the charge against him. He's a veteran. He's a Christian man, McLean said. He never, never would do anything like this unless he was in fear for his life. McLean said she learned of the shooting from Sutherfield's ex-wife about noon Friday. She said he wasn't trying to run when he was caught at the checkpoint. No, he was just going to go for a quick vacation, I guess, before he got locked up. Well, I guess maybe that mother knew her son at one time, but after being conditioned by the military-industrial complex, I don't think she knows him like she used to. But, yeah, okay, that's about it on that one.
And again, he could be a fall guy for the rest of everybody else. You know, the whole thing is set up and staged to be either thing. It could be occurring, or they might have just postured it to take him out. And, you know, who knows? That's what they've used against humanity all this time. They pit and polarize parents against children, and children against parents, sister against brother, and brother against sister. And these things, this is what Revelation says. You know, here's mom screaming out, he's not that kind of being. He's a Christian, and creating these copy holds, by the way, Christian man and all these things. But the thing is that, you know, yes, he could have been broken throughout time, or he could just be being used as a fall guy for somebody else. And to have the chief of police, normally an FBI agent, standing out there and saying, we fight corruption, that also indicates that he's a fall guy. But like I said, something occurred. Somebody's going to be held accountable for it. At this point in time, you have knowledge that you're working for a criminal enterprise, so whatever happens, happens. You can either walk away, choose your side, or stay there and continue to have these things occur upon you.
Yeah, the redistribution of these entities is picking up steam. I can't even keep up with all the stories coming up on my radar. I've been trying to do a few of the you know, most profound ones that I come across, or you know, like this was interesting about McGruff, the crime dog actor, getting 16 years for drugs and a grenade launchers, multiple grenade launchers. Let's see, I covered several in the Civil War being staged between cops and citizens on my YouTube channel a couple days ago. And, you know, in that one they covered where that cop had arrested that fireman for not moving the fire truck, even though the fireman was following the policy for the safest way to, you know, park, which was in front of the ambulance, to keep the ambulance out of harm's way while they're treating victims. Now, this is going on, remember, while victims are being treated that this fireman is assisting with.
Right, and we've seen a lot of that this year with cops interfering in first responders' works in order that people may die. Now, this isn't funny anymore. When a vehicle or whatever is more important than a human being, and you have to realize, I know this is a radio show and everything else, but that's a fire truck in front of an ambulance or vice versa. Big flashy lights, big red thing. It's not likely a target for car accidents because people are unaware. And, you know, there wasn't any indication that the weather was bad or getting bad or a blizzard going on where you couldn't see the fire truck. This seems to be like an intentional action of corporate counsel by which to kill people who were there being treated by first responders. And the tool of that was, of course, that cop directed to arrest the firefighter. And now the cop's going to be the fall guy.
Now, another similar story I saw, I don't have it pulled up in front of me, but the guy, the spokesman for the SAFE Act, I believe it was, which has to do with guns on school grounds, mm-hmm. was arrested for carrying a weapon on school grounds.
Aww.
I'll have to look that one back up.
Goes around, comes around. God's not very happy using his name in vain, posting him, doing all of these things. And once he's able to open that book and realize what it says, his wrath will be made known. And it'll happen in 1 hour. When you least expect these things, you're going to be picked up as a cop with a DUI or charged as a cop for shooting somebody in the face. Charged as an attorney for embezzlement, stealing cars that aren't reported stolen, robbing banks, robbing gas stations, you know, all of these things. In 1 hour, this will come upon you.
Now, you know, again, okay, spending just another moment on that story with the cop and fireman. Does that seem like a common sense thing to do? I bet you dirt to dollars he was poked on by some corporate counsel attorney telling them to do this.
Absolutely.
Because they're trying to fester the civil war between police and citizens.
Absolutely.
It's exactly their function. And so it takes the heat off of their ass.
Right. And the cops can be the fall guy for this. Not corporate counsel that was directing the deaths of people there, human beings. You know, all they have to do is buy 1 minute sometimes. You know, if somebody's in an accident and there's first responders on the scene, there's an emergency going on. Somebody's, you know, damaged. A human being, life is in danger. And when corporate counsel directs law enforcement to enforce policy during those times, 30 seconds can be mean life or death. And they know this, but the cop is going to be the fall guy. And they've done this over and over and over again, especially as we're seeing everything come down this year. You know, it's foul. Absolutely horrifying.
So let's get back to the attorneys. Boston CBS Local, Somerset, Massachusetts. A Somerset man whose right to practice law has been revoked is facing federal charges stemming from allegations that he stole about $300,000 from two investors who were promised hefty profits within 3 months. Massachusetts State Secretary William Galvin alleges that 55-year-old John Sevelia Jr. spent the money on gifts to relatives, payment for life insurance premiums, and Red Sox season tickets.
Wow.
The U.S. District Attorney's Office said Sylvia was arrested Friday and charged in a complaint with mail and wire fraud. Conviction carries a maximum sentence of 20 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Well, so, more than that attempted murder. Did you see that?
Yeah.
It's a financial crime. He defrauded other attorneys, by the way, other bankers, investors. Isn't that nice?
The complaint also named Richardson Consulting, LLC, there's your limited liability corporation.
Absolutely.
And Beltway Realty, LLC. Let's see how much limited liability they have now that they're under the bus as a new surety.
Yeah.
Which were two companies controlled by the suspect that were allegedly used to perpetrate the scam. Sylvia's attorney was not listed in the federal case file.
Cha-ching! Under civil forfeiture. Everybody's going to cash in on those limited liability companies and their insurance corporations. Cha-ching! Come on. This stuff needs to stop. Everybody patronizing these attorneys needs to look at what they're doing. They're patronizing this thing, calling it their father. Jesus specifically says, call no man your father. Matthew 23. Not even Christ. Stop doing these things. Patronize your own houses.
Now, what did we find them guilty of first, Tammy?
Kidnapping. And then human trafficking.
Human trafficking.
And then genocide.
Right. This is from the IndianaLawyer.com. Man is first charged under federal human trafficking law. This came down February 5th, 2014. U.S. Attorney Joe Hogsett announced Tuesday that his office has filed a 9-count federal indictment against an Indianapolis man for human trafficking. These are first-of-a-kind charges in Indiana, according to U.S. Attorney's Office in the Southern District of Indiana. Charges against Jerry Mitchell include sex trafficking of a child, and transporting a child to engage in prostitution. His arrest comes after federal and local authorities joined forces to combat human trafficking and child exploitation. Now, what took them so long to get their ass in gear in the first place?
Because they wanted to continue patronizing the bank.
Right. So,
this is coming down, everybody.
Again, this is more evidence of the surety at Northern Holding Corporation at work on the new surety now. Not the human beings anymore. We've taken that off you. Okay, so the presumption here is life. And if you haven't harmed anybody, okay, they're to leave you alone. That's part of the public law, what we're trying to get the system under. Okay? And it seems to be heading that direction, but I don't know. We just need a little more media coverage of this or some more people to get it or something. Anyways, he's accused of transporting women and female minors to facilitate their prostitution activities and on a number of occasions sexually assaulting the female minors. He also allegedly made a video recording of the sexual abuse of a 16-year-old victim. This case was the result of a collaborative investigation spearheaded by the Indiana Protection for Abuse and Trafficked Humans, one of 42 task forces nationwide funded by the department to address the issue of human trafficking. IPATH was created in 2006 and is chaired by the United States Attorney's Office and the Office of the Indiana Attorney General. The Attorney General who basically thumbed his nose at me when I was firing off evidence to him. See, the group meets regularly to collaborate on cases and projects, provide additional training to law enforcement, and raise awareness in our community about human trafficking. If convicted, Mitchell faces up to life in prison.
Right. Now, if they continue this and protect humanity, then they can have special drawing rights. However, they don't get anything if they're not protecting human beings. Period. And I think that what we're seeing now is that they're turning and saying, oh, I better do something, because otherwise we're just dead, broken, busted here.
Let's see here. Let's see. This is more. This is Patriot news than anything, but list for impeachment supporters. You know, trying to impeach the president, trying to get Congress to impeach the president.
Yeah,
that's
Senate has the power. That's Congress. It's a joke.
That's gaining more steam, but yeah, again, that's a diversionary tactic.
Well, and the majority of the sheeple listening right now are thinking still that Clinton, Bill Clinton, was impeached. He was never impeached. They put on a really good show, and if I ask just the average citizen about the impeachment, they'll tell me, yes, he was impeached. No, he was never impeached. He was never impeached. They put on a really good show to make you feel like he was going to be, or he could have been, or maybe he was. He was never impeached. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. And now, of course, they're reselling that to you in the media right now.
And
Hillary to say she was
she's going to forgive him. So they're pushing this forgiveness idea, you know.
Absolutely, and that's the foundation of their system. Forgive them, and then you know, pick another one of them. That one is just corrupt. Not the whole lot of them or anything. Just that one. So keep recusing your judge and firing your attorneys and hiring more attorneys, and never ever ever go look and you know, see what fee splitting is. And the reason that an attorney is required to have another attorney in place before they step out of the case is because of fee splitting. It allows the next attorney to cash in, and the previous attorney cashes in on the case throughout the case. He's never really gone. The first, second, third, fourth, fifth attorney, they all get shares under the action known as fee splitting. So you're never really getting them out of the picture. They just make a really good appearance. And it's the same with the judicial recusals. Why would you want to recuse them? They're all corrupt.
You know, yeah, speaking of that, Rand Paul was out there making a plea, you know, that the, you know, the GOP doesn't turn around here, that they're going to find Texas being a blue state in 10 years. And I read that into a YouTube video earlier, and, you know, it just made me sick to think of another 10 years of Congress. All right, we're right here at the verge of casting these chains off of us. You know, of course, these people that, you know, Rand Paul has been set up by his father, the good Congress guy, like there's such a thing, you know.
There's a proper way and an improper way to human trafficking.
Yeah, as Judge Simon said in our USDC case, freaking nutballs. So, you know, I'm sorry for you people that, you know, got caught up into the Rand Paul quote unquote movement, but he was just another face of Congress. He's responsible for moving all the gold out of the country. That's what his book, The Case for Gold, was all about. Now, everybody's wondering, well, where's the gold? Well, why don't you talk to Dr. Paul about that? Maybe he's got a better idea where the gold is, because we don't know.
Well, you can read it in his book. Yeah. This is where it went, you know, give it up, trade it for those FRNs. And for everybody that, you know, their eyes are wide and they're like, oh my God, Texas is going to be a blue state, meaning liberal or Democrat. Go back to the turn of the century, the 1900s, and look at the Democrats back then. They were the conservative party up until 1938 with Starr Diseases. There was a paradigm shift in the 1930s, of course. The KKK was brought up by Simmons, which was, at that time, he was a Democrat, but he was displaying characteristics of a conservative party, a Republican. Well, what had happened is that the paradigm shift, they shifted and became the Liberal Party. And of course, it was the Democrats who came in the 1960s, having already postured in the 1920s and 30s with affirmative action. Now, because there was no racism, because there was no sexism, who cashed in on that? Same Democratic, liberal, retarded, conservative, Republican, liberal, independents. It's the same party. It's called insider trading. So if you want to set up your investment plan, you're going to develop a means of production, which was the KKK, invoking racism, promoting racism. And then you come in later as the same racist and you say, oh, we need to do something about this. And a blue state of Texas. Another paradigm shift is what they're trying to promote and sell us. But it will not go that far. If sheeple finally wake up and realize there are no parties, there are no countries, there are no anything, there's corporations. That's it. That's it. And, you know, I urge everybody to watch that, The Network, 1974, The Network. And, you know, you can find clips of it on YouTube. I play clips of it right here on thesechangingtimesradio.me.com. And it's interesting to see, you know, especially Ned Beatty. Now, here's a primetime mainstream media, and Ned Beatty's going off on the television anchor. And he says, you've been meddling in corporate business here, and I have a great offer for you. And he says, well, why do you want me? He says, you're in the media, dummy. Bottom line, you're in the media, dummy. You're the one that's supposed to promote my agenda. That's who the media is for. And if you want a look into hegemony, which is what that is, to control power, status quo power and authority, you know, watch those. Study Bernays. Study Gramsci, Antonio Gramsci, and his works and his theory on hegemony and state and civil society. You know, study the consent and the force required to consent. Study fourth generation warfare. Study low intensity conflict. Look at the dynamics. Look at the characteristics and the tactics employed, and you will see that you are in the war. And you also see how to get out of it. It only takes a little bit. And, you know, I've been told for years, that'll take me 20 years to get through that stuff. I've been doing this for 14 years. And it's not bad. It's worth it for humanity. Wake up. Things are not important. Human beings are everything. Any life on this planet. You know, stop weighing these things in your hand. And when you come out with a weight that says a thing is more important than a human being, get out of here. Get away from me. Stay away from me and my family.
Now, in my case, we met resistance with several clerks.
Absolutely.
That were in the act of perpetuating, you know, obscuring the court record and keeping things off the court record. So I always brought a witness with me when I could and documented these things. And in one case, we witnessed a clerk altering my documents.
Absolutely.
And that was Rocko that was actually with me, and he did a declaration from his house to mine, which is the only way to do a declaration.
Right.
But, all right, aside from that, moving beyond that, we got, you know, back to the rooster coming home to roost, or nest. Trial rescheduled for St. Joseph County clerk's office worker accused in catfishing scam. St. Joseph County, Indiana, a woman accused of posing as two fake Marines. Now, I don't understand the writing in this. How can a woman pose as two Marines? But, all right, looking beyond the typographical. In order to coax thousands of dollars from Michiana residents, was in court Wednesday. The trial date for Kim Savage has been moved to March 20th. The 44-year-old faces theft charges stemming from 7-year catfishing scam. Back in October, two women came forward to the St. Joseph County Police Department. Pair said Savage posed as two United States Marines serving overseas needing money for protective equipment. Again,
No, that's right. I mean, they wear different masks. You know, all throughout time, there was this one woman years ago pretending to be Trudy. Okay, I won't say the last name. Well, then later on, she pretended to be this lady named Terry. Same pictures, different poses, and she was screwing males in the men's rights movement as a human agent. So she would sleep with these males, and then later she would come in and say, well, you know, he slept with me or whatever else, trying to vilify them. But that was her position in the scheme of things as a human agent. So that's interesting that they're nailing a human agent. Human, H-U-M-I-N-T, meaning human intelligence. They're there to garner human intelligence through human interaction.
Yes, and you see them all over the place. You know, I won't get into that right now. But anyways, the woman gave Savage tens of thousands of dollars. Up until her arrest, Savage worked as the head bookkeeper at the St. Joseph County Clerk's Office. The clerk's office is confident Savage didn't obtain or make any connection with the victims while she was at work.
Aw, they cleaned their hands. They said no.
Yeah.
Her father forsaked her. She's forsaken by her father. That's beautiful. I don't know her. I don't know her. I don't know her. Don't touch me. No, it's not us. She did that outside of her employment. That's funny.
Now, so this isn't anybody that I dealt with, although I did deal with that counter. Okay. So, we'll be watching what happens on there, because there are more involved that directly were in violation of 18 U.S.C. 1501. And perhaps even 1506. When you assault a process server.
Right, and Robert Richard was one of our process servers at several times.
Yep. So let's see. Another one. Here in Indiana, school counselor faces sexual exploitation charges. This is in Muncie, Indiana. New Castle school counselor faces sexual exploitation charges for allegedly giving male students drugs and alcohol and taking nude photographs of them, often with hidden cameras.
That's what psychiatrists do.
Yep. U.S. Attorney Joe Hogsett announced the charges against Daryl Hughes, 55, of Muncie, at a news conference Monday. Okay. So, sick. Hughes faces one count of sexual exploitation and two counts of attempted sexual exploitation. The Star Press, the Courier Times, New Castle report, he could face 15 years in prison if convicted. Authorities say the charges stem from incidents dating from 2008 and involve five youths who met Hughes after struggling with disciplinary issues at school.
At school. Disciplinary issues at school. So the same psychiatrist is telling your boys, you're a bad boy. You're in trouble. You're a bad boy. And then he took advantage of these children at school. The Hitler Youth Camps.
Hughes was arrested Friday. And this is dated February 3rd. So this is probably a week ago Friday. Newcastle Community School Superintendent Steve Fisher says he has been suspended without pay from his job as a behavioral consultant. So yeah, he's a damn psychiatrist.
Yeah, he's a monster. That was his function. That is what he does. He drugs children rapes and molests them and gets away with it because he's telling those same children that they're bad. And there's not only five. How long was he in that position? Did it say?
No, it doesn't. But it says he was 55, so I'm guessing a good number of years.
Or if you go to JimHopper.com, Jim Hopper maintains that 1 in 6 male children are sexually abused before they're 16 years old. 1 in 4 females are sexually abused before they're 16 in the United States Incorporated. And this occurs day after day. This is their function. The function of psychiatrists is to rape your children, to molest them, to take pictures of them and sell them to judges and attorneys after they've been groomed and taught that they're bad, given drugs to forget what happens to them, although they have the physical reactions of what happens to them. Now, these children are going to be criminalized over and over again because they're acting out, right? They've been sexually abused by a male. Now, there's different levels of egregious activity. A female raped by a male can handle that. A male raped by a female can handle that. A female raped by a female or a male raped by a male, it's so much worse. There's so many different stigmas that are related with that. So many different shame factors and everything else. These children need us. They require our protection. Where is everybody? Yes, they're being held accountable now, but there needs to be more. There's a counselor in every school. Get them out of the school. Get your children out of public schools. Don't put them in those positions.
Yeah, and this crap goes on.
2 weeks ago,
looking at that same website here, then for Indiana, South Bend Council. Here we go. These are corporate council attorneys working for all the South Benders, behalf, representing them. They approved sewer rate increases. Isn't that nice?
Right. Keep patronizing them.
South Bend Common Council met Monday night to discuss a controversial sewer rate hike that would incrementally increase rates 5% every year for the next 3 years. 3 more years of this type of governance, how much can we take? Now, first of all, early on in the case, we put in the general welfare clause to
get back to the original contract with the Treasury.
Right, get back to the original contract. So now the sewers are run by a corporation. According to the general welfare, the corporations are supposed to be here for our benefit, not to prey on us, as they have been. Okay?
Now, these 15% increase in the next 3 years is already on top of the 30% they're already getting. So that's a 45% tax. Keep patronizing it. Keep calling it your daddy. Now, these are rate increases, not taxes. They're sold to you as rate increases. That's aiding and abetting the known enemy of mankind if you pay those.
Yep, back in Indiana again. More sick garbage here. I mean, as if marriage licenses aren't bad enough. Indiana Senate Committee passes same-sex marriage amendment 8-4.
Yep, so now they're hooking in the gays, homosexuals, lesbians. They're getting them in the same system where they can rent each other, rent their rights to be, buy their rights to be. And it's all founded on privacy laws enacted by the same criminal that's stealing your rights. So, for example, if two people are in love with each other and they're not married, they don't have a right according to the criminal enterprise of inheritance. Now, if you want to accept this, keep patronizing it. If you don't want to accept this, stop patronizing and calling it your father. It's preying on humans equally. Those are your equal rights. Now, homosexuals just got the right to be raised by court process.
Now, I could give a rat's ass about, you know, who you want to be with, I guess. It doesn't really affect, as long as it doesn't affect me or cause anybody harm, you know, that's all the public law is about, you know. But now they're going to get, you know, these people in same-sex marriages into marriage contracts, which is further in bed, you know, with the state, the federal state.
Right. When in all reality, they already are. If they're married by the intent, they're married by intent.
Why are you seeking the approval of this federal state that's preying on you?
And that's what allows them to get at your inheritance. You're the heir. Every time you file a will, it allows the attorneys to get in between you and the inheritance. The action of interpleading. Stop patronizing this thing.
Well, okay, so that's about it for the news, and we've been on 3 hours, and I guess it's time to give you folks a rest here, and time for me to calm down a little bit here. This stuff's very upsetting.
Absolutely. I'll have this up within a few minutes, folks. Thanks for listening. You've been listening to After Hours with Bo and Tami, thesechangingtimesradio.ning.com. Be well.
Be well.